so much coaching you can do. And I think it's pretty plain to see Lovey doesn't have his recruits in place yet. He doesn't have the squad necessary to implement whatever system he's trying to implement here at Illinois. So, you know, I don't expect there to be much of a coaching battle per se. I'll wait for Illinois to prove me wrong.
So Chase McLaughlin will kick things off for the Illini. Jabro Peppers, of course, back to return for the Wolverines. Peppers fields the kick at the 5. Has plenty of room to run. Cuts left. Cross towards the 25, tackled right there. On the tackle for Illinois, Dre Brown. And that's where Michigan will get things started. Wilton Spate will be under center for the Wolverines, as Morris mentioned in the pregame. A new offensive line for this Wolverine squad. Ben Bredesen playing left guard. Ben Braden on the right side at tackle. Juwan Bushelbeedy had trouble 2 weeks ago at Rutgers. Obviously playing kind of the third string right tackle there. First play from scrimmage. Davion Smith, hand of the ball. 6 yards up the middle.
Nice little counter run up the gut from the Wolverines. The right side will definitely be the strong side today for the Wolverines. We already discussed how it could be a weak point on the offensive line, but also Illinois' danger man on the defensive line is DeJuan Smoot, and he'll be going up against Ben Braden on that left tackle's position.
Poggi in as the fullback. Davion Smith the tailback, I-4. Hand off to the right side. Davion Smith, lots of room, has a hole. Gets hit at the 35, keeps going. Brought down at the 40 by Julian Jones.
Good push up front for the Wolverines. This Illinois defensive front has surrendered some good rushing games to the likes of Purdue and Rutgers. Michigan markedly more successful than both of those offenses on the ground. Expect to see a lot more of that today.
Spade under center, first and 10 from the 41. Two out wide to the right. Now butt in motion over to that right side. Looking to pass. Quick throw to J.U. Chesson, in and out of his hands. Through behind the receiver. Tough pass there from Wilton Spate. Not able to find the man. Second and 10.
We've seen a lot of inaccuracy from Wilton Spate over the first 6 games of this season. You can't complain with the record Michigan has had with him at the helm. But, you know, this is a game also where I wouldn't expect to see Wilton Spate tested a ton. Michigan should be able to move the ball on the ground. But you'd like to see better than that.
Wilton Spate certainly needs to find a way to perform if this Michigan team is going to be able to compete with their better opponents down the line. Toss play to the right side. Ty Isaac across the edge. Cuts upfield. Across the 45, tackled around the 47. 6 yard gain there on second down.
Interesting to see Shane Morris in as quarterback on that play, tossing for Ty Isaac and then throwing a bit of a block downfield. He's shown a willingness to lower the boom. Not typical out of a quarterback, but something that'll get him on the field.
Wilton Spake back on the field for 3rd and 4. Two man set up in the backfield. Collin Hill on the right side. Ty Isaac the tailback. McDoom in motion. Pulls up short. Now McDoom cutting back on a screen. He has a wide open space across the 50, across the 40, up the sideline. Cuts away from a man. 20. Tackled at the 19-yard line. A big play from Eddie McDoom. That throwback screen. And the Wolverines are threatening as they enter the red zone on their first drive of the day.
That fake jet action was really sexy from the Wolverines. Every time McDoom's been on the field all season, you expect him to come across formation and take the handoff. That time, he stopped, and as soon as the ball was snapped, cut the other direction. Illinois not at all prepared for it. That whole side of the field wide open.
Jim Harbaugh on the Michigan sideline urging the crowd to quiet down. Jabril Peppers in at quarterback. Peppers has the snap. Takes it himself, fakes a give up the middle. Hit hard around the 16-yard line. Seems to be all right. 3.5 yards there on first down.
Now, it's been rumored all year that Peppers, in addition to being a dynamic threat on the ground, also has a bit of an arm, can make the throws downfield. He hasn't gotten the chance to do so far this year, but it's something that I'd like to see today against the Illini.
The spot gives Michigan 4 yards, 2nd and 6 from the 16. Chris Evans in at tailback. Check that. Karan Higdon. Higdon gets the handoff. tripped up near the line, and just brought down by an arm tackle in the secondary. Stanley Green prevented Michigan from finding the end zone. It'll be first and goal from the 9-yard line.
Michigan appears to be running a lot of counter action. I think the Illini expect them to run over that right side time after time, and I'm not sure whether it's the running backs just finding a cutback lane or by design, but they've had a lot of room to the backside.
Peppers in as the running back now, but Will Spate remains in the game in the shotgun. Peppers looking for a pass. Catches the ball at the 5-yard line. Steps right out of bounds at the 4. They rule it a catch. It looked like his foot might have been down as he caught the ball. We'll see whether or not they rule this one a completion.
Yeah, I think what happened is as he caught it, his right foot landed in bounds, quickly followed by his left foot landing out of bounds. So that's going to be a catch for about a yard from Jabril Peppers. But, you know, that's where being a defensive player comes into play. Not quite the awareness you'd expect out of a normal running back out of the backfield.
That's a good call, Morris. That is indeed what happened. Right foot beat the left foot by about half a second to give Michigan about 5 yards there on first down. It's 2nd and 4. Rather, 2nd and goal from the 4. Heavy set package. Peppers in it. Quarterback, 3 guys there to hand the ball off to. He gives it to Smith. Rather, he keeps it himself, upended as he crossed the 3. Spotted down there as Julian Jones made the tackle. Peppers comes out of the game. Now they'll go back with a heavy set package with 2 tight ends, and it's the train package with Wilton Spate walking down the line, all but 10 men lined up, and now they take the line of scrimmage. We saw that a couple weeks ago against Wisconsin. Wilton Spate back to pass, looking right, has a man wide open, that's Jake Butt, into the end zone, Michigan touchdown.
America's tight end streaking across the field on the curl route. You can see it from the moment the play began, going against the momentum of the Illini defense, wide open, easy pitch and catch toss for Wilton Spate.
Jake Butt, his 4th touchdown reception on the year. Kenny Allen, the man on for the extra point. There's been a competition between he and Ryan Tice these past couple weeks after a couple of shaky misses against Wisconsin. Allen's kick is good. Wolverines lead 7-0. There's 10:23 to go here in this first quarter. Wolverines on top on homecoming day in Ann Arbor. You're listening to WCBN Sports. Eli Sherman and Boris Fabry on the call.
Spate did miss the one moderately difficult throw that he had on that drive, and I guess that's a cause for concern. But it's so refreshing to see Michigan just run the ball down the Illini's throats. You know that they're running it. The Illini know that they're not a threat to go downfield, but still running lanes are open because of the diversity that Michigan can have, even while keeping the playbook relatively conservative as far as what they're asking of Wilton Spate at the quarterback position.
So just to recap you on that drive, 10 plays, 75 yards, 4:37 off the clock, a solid performance from the Wolverines. They really ran the ball down the throats of the Illini, 34 yards across 6 guys carrying the ball, or excuse me, 6 attempts, 4 rushers, none longer than 9 yards on that touchdown drive to open this game. Wolverines, we expected them to do really well against this rushing defense, not having to go to the air too much early on. Wolverines honoring Devin Funchess down on the Michigan sideline, back to visit here on homecoming day, acknowledging his performance in the Super Bowl last year on the losing side of things with the Carolina Panthers. Our Leo Blavin is giving indications of perhaps poor performance, but we won't get into that on this broadcast. So the Wolverines, 2nd in the nation in a scoring offense, 50 points per game. Not a fantastic passing offense, however. Wilton Spate, his performance has netted the Wolverines a middling 8th in the Big Ten in terms of yardage. Does Michigan need to develop their passing offense more as this season goes out, or can they rely on this rushing offense, to carry them. You'd expect that between now and that Saturday after Thanksgiving, they aren't going to have too much trouble with any staunch defenses. But Ohio State certainly, they know how to handle a good rushing offense. What do you think is Michigan's goal as far as development?
Look, Michigan only needed Wilton Spate to be good for one throw against the Wisconsin Badgers. They won't even need him to be that good against the rest of the schedule. And against Ohio State, let's be real, he's not going to be throwing for 500 yards against the Buckeyes or, later down the road in the Big Ten Championship game or Crimson Tide if the Wolverines make it that far.
Some strong implications there, Marks.
Just needs to be able to manage the game, make a couple of key throws.
Line drive kick fielded by Kendrick Foster up across the 20, tackled at the 21-yard line. A line drive kick off the foot of Kenny Allen on that one.
And that was Eddie McDoom. Had a key play on offense and gunning down the field on the kickoff. The first man making contact and leading to the Illini start at the 21.
And so now we'll get a chance to see Jeff George, the third string quarterback for this Illini offense. He is no Juice Williams, to say the least.
Man, those were some fun Illinois teams. This will be
Foster in as the tailback. George in the shotgun. Fakes the give, looking across the middle. Deep downfield. And pass interference called on Channing Stribling, or he expected to be pass interference.
Now, I think that was Jordan Lewis. Lewis in coverage against Justin Hardy, it appeared, downfielder. Maybe Malik Turner. Got a lot of contact. It's the kind of stuff he'll get away with based on his reputation sometimes, but I think it's going to
there are two there. Fouls on the play. Personal foul, chop block, offense, pass interference, defense. The penalty's offset. Replay first down.
That was head referee Ron Snodgrass making the call there. So both of us ended up being wrong, though they didn't give us a number to indicate who the defensive pass interference.
Since when was I wrong? It was defensive pass interference. That was Jordan Lewis with the contact.
We didn't confirm that it was Jordan Lewis. In any case, two running backs in for the Illini, and Jeff George Jr. going out on a wildcat play. Kayshawn Vaughn gets the direct snap tackle near the line of scrimmage, about a yard to gain. Taco Charlton on the tackle.
Good work by Damonte Thomas to crack it down from his safety position. Michigan looking to be aggressive to start the game against this Illini offense.
The Illini play with a no-huddle offense. Lots of movement on that line pre-snap. Vaughn and Foster, the running backs. George Jr. under center, making an audible, and now he runs out again. Wildcat play coming up. Ball through the hands of Vaughn in the backfield, picks it up. Wolverines trying to tackle him. They get him for a loss. He got about 5 or 10 yards back from where he picked it up. Ball went all the way back to about the 7-yard line, ultimately tackled at the 17. Ed Gedeon on the tackle. So the Michigan Wolverines get a gift there. Not that they necessarily needed the help defensively. And it's 3rd and 13 from their own 18. Illinois. Split way out wide is Vaughn. Three out wide to the right. They're spreading the field. George with an empty backfield. Looking right. Thrown across the middle. Tipped at the line. Incomplete. The Wolverines get a 3 and out to start things off defensively. Ben Gedeon on a pass break.
It's an impossible task for Jeff George to be asked in his first career start with the Illini to operate against this Michigan defensive line. You got to have a quick hitter because, frankly, the Illinois offensive line is not going to be able to hold up to this Wolverines pass rush. The throw was well short of the sticks, and it was incomplete anyway because Michigan had it covered.
Ryan Frayne on to punt this one away. Wolverines look like they're going for the block. Peppers back to return. Peppers waits for the fair catch, fields it at the 41. He's hit as he comes down. No flag yet. You'd expect to see kick catch interference.
I think they're going to rule that Peppers was kind of falling into the Illinois gunner as he made that fair catch. It's, you know, it's contact, but it was mostly just incidental.
Harbaugh down there arguing with the referees. He wants the call. I'm surprised at that one. He only had about half a yard of space to catch that ball. He did kind of lean forward as he caught the ball, but nevertheless, if the returner is getting knocked over by the gunners, you'd think that's automatic at this point, given the stress on player safety in the NCAA these past couple years.
Yeah, I don't think Peppers had enough space to make a catch to be reasonably expected to make the catch. And if he had fumbled in that kind of a situation and no flag was thrown, I would have been pretty irritated as a Michigan fan.
And looking down at the field, there is a flag that it appears they just dropped down there. We'll get the announcement after the TV timeout. But the flag is sitting at the 41-yard line. You'd expect perhaps Michigan, I believe the call on this is a 15-yard personal foul, kick catch interference. So it would give Michigan the ball in Illinois territory. They are still honoring past Michigan heroes.
In the previous play, there was a foul for kick catching interference on the kicking team, number 26, 15-yard penalty, number 46, 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul, first down Michigan.
And you know, we're still in the middle of our TV timeout, so that's a call you would only hear on WCBN-FM Ann Arbor's broadcast of Michigan football. That's why you're tuned in to us.
So Michigan gets another break there. Kick counter interference called on number 46, who doesn't show up on Illinois' roster. They have a 45 and they have a 47, but no 46. So we can't get you a name on that one. But nevertheless, the Wolverines will get the ball at the Illinois 44-yard line to start things off as soon as they return from the TV timeout.
Perhaps an Illini band member put on pads and on short notice they had to go cover punts against Jabril Peppers. I certainly wouldn't want to.
Well, Illinois' band did not make the trip given the alumni band being here this afternoon for the Wolverines. Colin Hill and Chris Evans in there for the Wolverines. Wilton Spade under center from the 44. Fakes the handoff. Looking left, he has Hill. Hill cutting up the left side of the field. Went out of bounds at the 37. Good pickup there on first down, 7 yards. It'll be second and three.
Another sort of easy pitch and catch play from Spade to Khalid Hill. But you like that he led Hill perfectly, gave him the time to turn up field and get to the sideline, avoiding, you know, any unnecessary contact.
Michigan in the I form, two out wide to the right. That's Darbo and Chesson. Poggi, the fullback, the give to Evans. Up the middle, he has a lot of space. Hit hard across the 25. Brought down by Carroll Phillips
from like
behind, and it looks like Evans is down and hurt. He did take a hard hit.
Looked like the ball came loose as well as he was on his way down. He got crunched from multiple sides. Jake Butt pounced on the loose ball, so not going to be a turnover in any case, but you just want to make sure Chris Evans is okay right now.
And also, Evans' helmet came off, a clear helmet-to-helmet hit. Not intentional by any means, but he will be going through the concussion protocol after this one. Now the whole team coming onto the field, taking a couple players taking knees. So clearly it does not look good down on the field there for Chris Evans. Again, a hard hit. Face mask to face mask. The man who hit him for Illinois, Stanley Green, he also looked a little discombobulated right off the hit, unsettled. But he did walk off the field.
Evans is moving his feet down there. Looks like he's sitting upright now, but he'll probably have to be helped off the field in this instance. Michigan, from a team-wide standpoint, plenty of depth. Drake Johnson recently returning from injury. We're probably going to see some of him today, especially now that the guys in front of him have been reduced in depth by one player. I wouldn't expect to see Evans again in this one.
Jabril Peppers went down there for a second. He was the one man comforting Evans down there Now he's helped up. He's got two trainers on either arm guiding him off the field, but walking under his own power. And it doesn't look quite as bad as it did at the first instance. Shaken up. Looked like a potential head or neck injury based on the replay. And as you said, I think it's likely that we won't see Evans for the remainder of the day. Michigan has three other very solid tailback options, and of course Drake Johnson, a fourth option now back from injury, of course hasn't played all season, so he's a bit rusty, and at least you'd expect him to be. But nevertheless, Michigan not going to try and overextend themselves against an inferior run defense. Evans, with a 7-0 lead.
Evans, attended to by a few team physicians, he was sat down. Now he's on his feet, and it looks like he's going to be walking off the field toward the locker room.
Evans taking the long route around the north end zone. Just waiting for things to get going here again. We have 8:07 remaining on the clock here in the first quarter. Wolverines first and 10 from the Illinois 21-yard line.
The ball is at the 21-yard line. First and 10.
OG and Smith in the I form. Freddie Canteen out wide to the left. Hand off to Smith. Play fake. Across the middle. He has his man into the end zone. Touchdown.
Tyrone Wheatley Jr. hasn't seen barely any playing time this year for the Michigan Wolverines, but there he was in motion across the formation. I didn't expect Michigan to go his way, given how little we've seen of him, but he ran a good route. He was wide open, and Wilton Spate put it right in his chest.
Tyrone Wheatley, that his first career touchdown in the maize and blue. Of course, his father, Tyrone Wheatley Sr., a coach on this staff here at Michigan. Kenny Allen on for the PAT. Kick is up. Kick is good. The Wolverines lead 14-0 here at home on homecoming weekend, beating up on these Illinois Fighting Illini at the University of Illinois. We have 7:52 remaining in the first quarter. You're listening to WCBN Sports. Eli Sherman and Morris Fabry here on the call on a beautiful Saturday afternoon in late October in Ann Arbor. The trees are orange and red as you look out across the landscape towards downtown. And it's certainly fall here in Ann Arbor. The Wolverines are feeling that fall weather. They're enjoying football season to the fullest.
The trees might be turning orange, but by no means should you interpret that as the city supporting the Illini out here on the field. Nothing is going in favor of the Fighting Illini so far. They've been outgained 119-3. I'd say that, like the Rutgers game, it's going to be a struggle for Illinois to get a first down today and get into positive yardage. Maybe a lot to assume going off one drive, but Michigan has looked the part of the number three team in the nation against an overmatched foe.
So that scoring drive, three plays, 44 yards, just 47 seconds. Much of that time, or at least much of the time in real time, not game time, dedicated to the injury timeout. Again, Chris Evans going down with what we've up here in the box interpreted as a probable concussion. Kenny Allen will be on to kick for the Wolverines. Kendrick Foster back to return. Jake Eckler, the forward man on the 10-yard line. Allen's kick. A little bit less of a line drive than the previous one. Lands 9 yards deep in the end zone and bounces out the back for a touchback. And Jeff George Jr. will come back out for this Fighting Illini team. They struggled mightily on that first drive. Not a completed pass to their credit. -3 rushing yards. That's their total offensive output for the day.
From the one pass he threw, or from the two passes he threw, we can conclude he's not that great through the air, but give him credit, he's at least better at catching this snap than the running backs who will come out in the Wildcat.
Reggie Corbin, the man to the right in the shotgun with George. Man in motion, Fake the give to Corbett. Looking downfield, hit as he throws. Pass in and out of the hands of Malik Turner, cutting across the middle near the 30-yard line. Incomplete. Ben Gedeon on the coverage in the backfield, hitting him as he threw, was Mike McCray, getting through that A-gap on Illinois' offensive line.
Dr. Blitz, Don Brown dialing it up against the Illini. You feel sorry for the kids out there. The kids wearing white, I must clarify.
George changing the line, changing the play at the line. He's going to go from under center. And in motion, that's the tight end. Cuts to the left, back to the right. Toss play, coming to the right side. Corbett cuts upfield, but brought down from behind. Chris Wormley, the big strong arms from that sensational defensive tackle. Brought down for a 1 yard gain. It's 3rd and 9 from the 26.
You won't find many interior linemen in the country who can pursue to the edges as well as Michigan's can. Ryan Glasgow and Chris Wormley, both incredible athletes for their positions.
George in the shotgun. 7 minutes left on the clock here in the first quarter.
Stribling and Lewis both in very tight coverage on the outside.
Changing the play at the line. He has Corbin to his right in the pistol. Handoff, cutting to the left, upfield. Kendrick Foster, he breaks a tackle, cuts across to the 43-yard line, brought down by Tyree Cannell. First down, Illinois. And after Michigan went deep into the fourth quarter 2 weeks ago before allowing their first down to Rutgers, they've allowed a first down here to Illinois in the first quarter.
Perhaps I spoke too soon.
Illinois going to the Wildcat. George coming to the right side this time. Direct snap to Vaughn. Vaughn in the backfield. Mike McCray in pursuit. Eventually brought down by Jordan Lewis. Mike McCray slowed him down. Jordan Lewis came in and got him down low. There is a man down for Michigan. And not moving. Feels to be Mike McCray grabbing the left ankle.
Yeah, Kashawn Vaughn, as he ran toward that left side, was tackled and kind of fell on Mike McCray, and I think he got his left leg caught under him as Vaughn was shoved onto him. So definitely a leg issue over there for McCray.
So Michigan already has lost Chris Evans here in this game. Went to the locker room. Mike McCray now down with some sort of lower leg injury on his left leg. And this would be a big loss for this Michigan line, or rather Michigan front seven. He's walking off under his own power, a slight limp, but nothing too severe.
We'd certainly hope it's nothing too severe. Devin Bush is going to see the snaps in his place.
Likely some tape on that ankle, and they'll bring him back in if they need him. Michigan again up 14-0. 6:13 left on the clock in this first quarter. Michigan's defense has performed strong in every aspect so far. Second and 18 from the 35. Ben Gedeon rushed the snap, hit as he throws, pass way short from Jeff George. Sean Gary on the pressure.
Looked like the center, Joe Spencer, might have started blocking before that play began. Michigan with a three-man front, a stunt that got going just as the ball was snapped, timed up the count perfectly, and George had no chance.
So 3rd and 18 for the Illini. George in empty backfield. Peppers creeping down, looking for an edge rush. Now he settles down and retreats back to the 45-yard line. Three out wide to the right, two to the left. George looking to throw to the right side. Pass broken up from behind by Channing Scribbling, getting the hand in there, that right hand. A nice job to control his man with the left hand down low where the referees can't see it. And the Wolverines have forced another punt from this Illini team. Ryan Frayne, the man to punt. Peppers, of course, back to return. goes for the block. Just getting it off in time was Frayne. Peppers takes the fair catch at the 19-yard line.
For a fair catch.
And the Wolverines will get started from there. 5:52 left on the first quarter here in Ann Arbor. You're listening to WCBN Sports Broadcast of University of Michigan Football. They're hosting the Fighting Illini of University of Illinois and Urbana-Champaign. I'm Eli Sherman alongside Boris Fabry. Our spotto is Leo Blavin here on a beautiful Saturday afternoon in Ann Arbor. A little bit chilly, a little bit windy, but it's sunny and there are just a few wispy clouds in the sky. Wolverines get started from the 19-yard line. Davion Smith, the single setback. Spade from under center. Hand off to Smith. He cuts up the middle as a little bit of room brought down from behind by Carroll Phillips.
And these Michigan running backs consistently, play after play, are getting at least 4 or 5 yards before even contact with the Illini defense. Good push up front through the interior from this Michigan offensive line.
Michigan 6 yards on that first down rush, and that's going to drop their average on the day by about 0.3 yards. They're averaging 7.1 on the day. Eddie McDoom, the end around, cuts up field across the 40 to about the 44-yard line. Big play there brought down by Darius Mosley.
You know, throughout the season, it's the jet sweep play that set up the counter early on in this game. Well, I think that counter set up the reversion back to the sweep itself as McDoom had room around the edge.
McDoom, 19 yards there on second down. Wolverines pick up a first down there, moving from their own 44 and driving once again, already up 14-0. Darbo on the right side. Three men in the backfield with Spate. Dropped the snap, but picks it up, hands it off to Isaac. Play fell apart a little bit. Isaac only able to pick up 3 yards there on first down. A little bit of extracurriculars after the play between Darbo and the cover corner, Jalen Dunlap. I've had to go in and break them up.
Yeah, I think over the past few games, Isaac has been the most impressive Wolverine out of the backfield. But as a running back, it's got to throw your rhythm off just a little bit when things don't go according to plan from the snap.
Trips right for the Wolverines. Jake Budd is the head of that three-man crew. Spate looking right. He has Chesson across the middle at the 40-yard line of Illinois. First down, Wolverines.
Nice throw there from Spate. I think Davion Smith moving out into the right flat might have been the first read for Wilton Spate, but good patience there to find Chesson and throw through a very tight window. A linebacker cutting across, almost got a fingertip on that ball.
Wolverines going heavy as Devin Asiasi and Colin Hill come into the game. Play seemed to be called, and now Wilton Spate looking back in towards the line. The play clock has gone dead. Timeout on the field.
This will be a 30-second timeout.
And now the Wolverines have called timeout. But looking at the two play clocks that you can see in the stadium, both of them have gone dead. You have to look a little bit further in on the scoreboard to see the play clock. It's not the conventional spot. We saw them doing maintenance on the clock, the normal clock, pregame, so perhaps they were having some electrical issues and they instead decided to add the play clock to the digital part of the scoreboard rather than the analog clock. And so perhaps Wilton Spate not seeing that right off the bat, and that caused a little bit of confusion, have to look a different spot. It's one of those things that you're used to seeing the play clock. You look for that in your walkthrough, and when it's not where you're used to looking at it, you have to call timeout to get things settled. Play fake there on first down, looking across the left side. He has Darbo at the 25. Darbo trying to cut around a man, almost breaks a tackle, but brought down there, unable to get his momentum. Moving upfield, brought down by Stanley Green.
Spate hit as he threw, didn't have the space to really step into that throw for Darbo, but great protection on the pass from this offensive line. That was a very slow developing play, and that's the kind of throw that, you know, while it's an easy throw you expect most college quarterbacks to make, it's the kind of throw that Spate has kind of been biffing from time to time, so it's encouraging to see him make that in stride to Amar Darbo.
Ty Isaac comes in for Davion Smith here on first down from the 19. Hand off to Isaac. Cuts up the middle on the left side. Brought down for 2 yards. Artie Nickerson, the middle linebacker on the tackle.
Looked like Mason Cole acquitted himself well, moving to the left to clear the hole open for Ty Isaac. He sealed off his man, and Isaac cut behind it, but not a lot of push from Bredesen and Braden on that left side of the line.
Michigan picks up 3 there on first down. Isaac stays in the game. Colin Hill, the fullback. In motion is McDoom on the sweep. They fake to him. Now Spate looking upfield. Doesn't have a man open. Takes it himself. Crosses the 10-yard line about the 8 where he's hit out of bounds. First and goal for the Wolverines from the 8. Patrick Nelson, the fans wanted a late hit out of bounds as Luke Spate was heading towards the sideline, but I think it's the right call there by the referees, as Wilton Spate could have considered turning it upfield given where he was at.
Well, it is Wilton Spate, so realistically, he was not going to ever turn that one upfield, but yeah, he was shoved while he was in play. I think it's reasonable that no penalty was called.
Flag on the field.
I'll step back up.
It appeared to be
substitution. Timeout, Michigan, their second. This will be a 30-second timeout.
So that flag coming in there, Michigan going for a late substitution. They're on first and goal. And the Wolverines instead take a timeout.
Yeah, maybe calling that to avoid the flag. You know, if you have to make one nitpick with the way the Wolverines have played so far, they've wasted 2 timeouts in the first quarter. But I can't imagine they're really going to need them down the stretch at the end of this half. And, you know, under Jim Harbaugh, this team has been competent in clock management. And that's an area that so many teams across the college circuit and in the pros seem to struggle with. It's nice to know that this team is in good hands as far as the coaching staff is concerned.
I will say that there have been a couple plays where there's been certainly confusion amongst the skill players of who's supposed to be on the line. You know, one of the running backs between Isaac and Smith will come out, and they're not sure if they're actually supposed to be out there or if the one that's already out there is supposed to stay on. And Michigan will have 12 men on the field for a good 5 or 6 seconds before the coaching staff gets things settled, and that wastes valuable time. In that case, we see Michigan having to take a timeout to avoid a late substitution penalty. Wolverines first and goal from the 6-yard line. Ty Isaac, the man in the backfield for the Wolverines. Colin Hill in there as well. Big heavy set. Henry Pogge also in there. Toss play to Isaac, moving left. Trying to cut upfield. Gets to the edge. Touchdown, Wolverines. A late call there as he just kicked the pylon out of the way. Third touchdown of the day for the Wolverines. The first one on the ground, but the Wolverines are turning this into the expected blowout. So far, 109 yards. Check that, 97 yards on the ground, 103 yards in the air. 3 touchdowns, and Kenny Allen looking for the extra point.
You know, when Michigan lines up in that heavy package, you have to be able to account for the fullback running up the middle. You have to account for
the previous plays under further review.
As I was saying, you have to account for a tailback running. You have to account for the tight ends being receiving threats. So Illinois not ready for that toss to the outside. Michigan didn't block it especially well. And, you know, Isaac, I think, you typically see running backs extend for the pylon, but Ty Isaac almost tripped over it. And I think it's a matter of where the ball was when he went out of bounds, but I don't see this play being overturned.
Isaac got kind of pushed from behind, that back right hip going towards the left corner of the end zone. And that might have been enough momentum to push him offline and out of bounds. Trey Watson, the linebacker, trying to push him out of bounds, keep him out of the end zone. I will say this, from the camera angles we've seen so far, it doesn't look like the ball actually crossed the plane. His foot certainly went over the corner of the end zone, but it appeared that you know, the ball stayed in front of and then to the left of the end zone the entire time. But perhaps it'll be difficult for this refereeing crew to overturn that one, given the video angles we've seen so far.
Interesting that we didn't see any Davion Smith on that drive from the Wolverines. Certainly, Jim Harbaugh has an embarrassment of riches in his backfield, a set of diverse talents. But Smith still at least listed as the number one guy on this team, very proficient in pass blocking. So you got to wonder if maybe he's been deterred from playing Smith due to the early injuries, or if it's an opportunity to get Isaac, you know, some reps out there with the first team.
Well, I will just correct you real quickly. The first play of the drive, Davion Smith, a 6-yard run on first down, and then the Wolverines have really opened things up. A nice pass from Wilton Spade across the middle on this drive.
That is
got true. A big chunk of the yards for the Wolverines.
He was in on that first series. I guess I'm just not used to seeing a team without a definite lead back have this much success on the ground.
But I will say, though, you know, to that point, the Wolverines have five rushers with greater than 10 yards. Smith leading the way for the Wolverines. Three carries, 22 yards. Eddie McDoom, one for 19. Ty Isaac, four for 18 yards.
When the ball's at the half-yard line, it'll be second down and goal from the left hash.
Sounds like an opportunity for the touchdown vulture himself, Khalid Hill.
So you heard there, Ty Isaac just a little bit out of bounds, and Morris, you make an excellent point. Three touchdowns 2 weeks ago against Rutgers for Khalid Hill. He leads this team in touchdowns and also in points. He is the fullback. Instead, they give it to Davion Smith. He's has his momentum stopped at the one-yard line. And they will mark it down there.
Just setting it up for Hill. You know, eventually the Wolverines are going to score, whether it comes on third and goal or fourth and goal from the one. It's just a matter of when they choose to give the ball to Khalid Hill. Khalid Hill is equivalent to touchdowns for this team.
Ball is marked at the ones, third and goal.
So it's third and one for the Wolverines, third and goal rather. Fake to Smith, throw over the top, pass interference. Jake Butt pushed down by the coverage. Julian Jones, the man, flag for that one. Two flags down on the field there. Both referees certainly seeing the same thing. Waiting on the referee to give the call.
Do we have a flag down?
His mic is on. I don't think he realizes as he continues the discussion with his referees.
Pass interference, defense, number two, half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
And so half the distance will net the Wolverines half a yard.
And a fresh set of downs.
Perhaps that's a more important part as it was third and one. Michigan going heavy once again. Colin Hill, the fullback. Asiasi in motion. Hand off to Hill. Pushes forward. Touchdown, Colin Hill.
Never in doubt.
Colin Hill at his eighth touchdown on 14 carries this season.
One way or another, Khalid Hill was going to be the man to score. I don't know why the Wolverines dilly-dallied and tried to spread the love. Khalid Hill is the guy in short-yarded situations. It's fun to see fullbacks have such an expanded role in this Jim Harbaugh team.
Well, and this is a joke, of course. Perhaps the play there was to not put the fullback dive on tape. They didn't want Ohio State to have too much to work with on that goal from down and goal from the one in order to try and counter that come late November.
Since when is it necessary to preface jokes with "this is a joke"?
I wanted to ensure that no listener would ever assume that I would actually think that the Wolverines aren't trying to put the fullback dive on tape, given that Khalid Hill already has eight touchdowns on the season.
Well, I would counter by saying that if your joke was funny to begin with, people would know that it was a joke just hearing it.
Stray fire from my broadcast partner, Morris Fabry. On the scoreboard now, they're honoring the 1996 Michigan National Championship hockey team. Last night at Yost, for those who missed it, in the Scoro game, which they do between the first and second periods, They had three members of that Michigan team doing Scoro. Normally, the contestants in Scoro are playing from just inside the blue line in the offensive zone. They have maybe 30 or 40 feet to shoot. In this case, Marty Turco, Brendan Morrison, and Mike Legg, three members of that championship team, were doing Scoro from behind the defensive blue line. So about a 150-foot shot. All three of them made their shots. Marty Turco, of course, a goalie, making a shot. Mike Legg doing his shot lacrosse style, like that famous goal against Minnesota in that NCAA tournament run. If you weren't there, you really got to go on Twitter and see the video on the Michigan hockey team's Twitter. It was fantastic. Perhaps the greatest hockey moment I have ever witnessed in person, on video, whatever. Kenny Allen, a low line drive kick across the center of field, fielded by the short man. He has a lot of space moving across the 30, brought down out of bounds by Kenny Allen. That's Nate Eckerd fielding the kick. Pushed out around the 43.
So the Illini are going to have some good field position. A rare miss kick from Kenny Allen. It didn't have that traditional end-over-end trajectory we're used to seeing out of him. Off note, Mike McCray out there with the defense to start this drive off, so fortunately his injury not that severe.
So they're actually going to say that Eckerd stepped out of bounds a little bit earlier. Ball marked at the 38 for Illinois. George looking to pass on first down, looking left. Has a man in and out of his hands up high. Flag coming down, looks like a roughing the passer penalty, perhaps on Taco Charlton.
And George had to get rid of that one quick. His man was totally blanking him.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. Defense, number 99, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
So Matt Godin, the man called for the roughing the passer, coming in from that right side. Still haven't seen a replay. Now we'll get it. It looks like he was already going down, just had his head on the ankle of Jeff George. Tough call for the Wolverines on that one.
He was being tackled by the center, Joe Spencer. I think he just kind of fell into Jeff George. That's a pretty horrific call.
Illinois going with the I form, and now out in the Wildcat is Jeff George. Keyshawn Vaughn, the Wildcat. Fakes the give, runs up the middle, brought down by Glasgow as he ran through the hole. Taco Charlton helping finish it off. 40 seconds left on the clock here in the first quarter. The Wolverines lead 21-0. You're listening to WCBN Sports, broadcast of University of Michigan football here on a lovely Saturday afternoon in Ann Arbor.
And we saw Josh Metellus sneak into the backfield almost as Vaughn got the snap. Michigan timing this Wildcat very well.
Wildcat yet again. Vaughn fakes the give, runs up the middle, brought down by Chris Wormley. That should do it for the first quarter here from Ann Arbor. Clock ticking in. 4-3-2-1. And so we head to the second quarter. The Wolverines lead 21-0 after one quarter of play. I'm now joined on the broadcast by Jeremy Parks, Executive Director at WCBN Sports. Jeremy, your thoughts on that first quarter? Michigan obviously dominating early here.
About as ho-hum as it could get, Sherman, from the kickoff. Michigan scoring on the first opening drive, and then Illinois follows it up with a three and out, and it's pretty much been the same song and dance for the entirety of the first quarter. Not expecting much to change here in the second. Wolverines giving up a few big plays in between, maybe a couple questionable calls on defense, but other than that, it's been the same dominant Michigan Wolverines team that we've seen all season long.
Michigan through one quarter of play, 200 yards of offense, 97 on the ground, 103 in the air. Two passing touchdowns for Wilton Spate. He's 7-8 on the day, so Just that one errant throw to J.U. Chesson threw behind him, and other than that, he's been perfect.
That would be a bright spot that I would throw out in this first quarter for the Wolverines. Wilton Spate has not looked fantastic in mid to short range passing games, especially over the middle. Sailing balls over the heads of receivers, not making confident throws out into the flat, hitting people behind and front too far. And so far today, as you said, 7 of 8, but those throws, intermediate range throws, I can recall very specifically one to J.U. Chesson right over the middle. It was a good job by Spate to show some poise in the pocket, hang in under pressure, and then fit a nice throw over the middle. And that's really that development that I think we're starting to maybe see from Wilton Spate. Everybody's making comparisons to last year with Jake Rudock and Jim Harbaugh, the quarterback whisperer of a coach who took Jake Rudock from, you know, fifth-year senior transfer student from Iowa to what should have been a backup quarterback on the Detroit Lions team. But I think we're finally seeing a renaissance here for Wilton Spate, maybe a little bit of production increase, and that's huge for the Wolverines going down the line. Again, everybody's looking forward to not just next week, but they all know what's at the end of the schedule. And if that game is going to be as close as everybody thinks it is going to be, Wilton Spate's going to have to make those throws.
Yeah, Michigan, perhaps the difference in that Ohio State game will be the offense. Those two defenses are, what everybody talks about, really. Ohio State's offense perhaps has the edge, but this Michigan defense, superb. It's going to be a chess match to end all chess matches. Certainly right now, the probability is creeping up week after week of those two teams being 11-0 when they play each other. Of course, that would be the first time since 2006 when the Wolverines dropped the game in Columbus 42-39. Ended up with a Rose
Bowl. The game
Bowl
of the century. The classic.
Absolutely. And perhaps this season, given the way these two teams have dominated, you would expect that, maybe that game would top the 06 game. But that's a debate for another day. These two teams, Ohio State and Michigan, have a couple games in between. Michigan currently playing one of those games, leading 21-0 against Illinois. But Illinois is driving thanks to a roughing the passer penalty. It's 3rd and 5. Peppers out, playing corner on the far left side. Jeff George in the shotgun alone. Looking to throw left, has a man across the middle. Out of his reach, Malik Turner, the intended receiver. Channing scribbling on the coverage coming across the middle. And Jeff George still has not completed a pass. 0-for-5 on the day.
And it looks like an injury on that offensive line for the Illini as well. Number 71, Joe Spencer, the center, getting up slowly, coming off gingerly to the sideline.
Seems to be favoring the left side. Maybe that left leg. Still hasn't sat down yet, so perhaps not too bad. A spread punt formation for Illinois. 2 on the game clock. Still no call on delay of game. Illinois getting a timeout, apparently. We'll see.
Delay of game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat fourth down.
So we saw Lovie Smith creeping towards the referee, but apparently opting for a little bit more field space, try and get one pinned deep in Michigan's own territory. Michigan now moving left to right as we see it. They have the wind at their backs here for this second quarter of play. Ryan Frayne, the punter. Andrew Burrow Peppers standing at the 12-yard line. Hasn't had an opportunity to return yet. Punt tipped at the line. Falls at about the 37-yard line. Bounces out of bounds there. Kalik Hudson on the near block for the Wolverines, getting deep into the backfield.
Kalik Hudson and Tyree Kinnell in as well on the block, tip punt. And I believe that's number 6 on the season for the Wolverine special teams unit.
Yeah, this Michigan special teams, of course, they have the one punt return for a touchdown by Jabril Peppers and a couple of near misses, but perhaps the bigger feather in their cap is the way that they've been able to get to the punter so far this season. Several near blocks and a couple true blocks converted for that front bunch. Spate looking to throw, hit as he throws over the outreach hand of Jake Butt downfield.
Spate was rolled out of the pocket there and made a poor decision, hit as he threw, and that one sailed over the hands of Butt, nearly intercepted as it fell harmlessly to the ground. Talking about Wilton Spate making those smart decisions and those confident throws, that was less of an example there.
And a lot of pressure on the right side of that line, which we mentioned at the start, was a bit of a question for the Wolverines shaking things up on the line today. Ben Braden playing right tackle. Hand off to Davion Smith on second down, barreling across the line. Picks up a first down, plus a few more, about 12 yards there on second and 10. Barreled over middle linebacker, churning those legs. Michigan moves into Illinois territory. It'll be first and 10 from the 49-yard line. Jabril Peppers checks into the game at tailback for the Wolverines, as well as Kakoa Crawford. Going to be split out wide to the left. Wilton Spate in the Wildcat, standing at the 50-yard line as a receiver. Jabril Peppers, the Wildcat quarterback. He has the ball, taking it himself, looking to run right. Cuts upfield to about the 45-yard line, brought down by several men.
Pretty basic play call out of the Wildcat there. Jabril Peppers able to just get that ball out to the right-hand side. He's still waiting for that moment that Jim Harbaugh gives him the green light to throw that ball. And that'll be the interesting day when we see him.
Kyle Taylor's a little bit slow to get up there. He was on top of Jabril Peppers. Perhaps something in his right leg, but he's going to stay in the game. You got to give it to the credit of offensive linemen everywhere. They are probably the toughest men on either side of the ball. Chris Evans back in the game, or rather Karan Higdon back in the game here. Gets a big run there on second down.
Higdon with that similar sneaky speed, 5'10", 189 pounds, lanky back, but he's able to squirt through those holes and go for big gains. We saw it two weeks ago, towards the tail end of the Rutgers game, showcasing what he's able to do when he gets into space, and that's another example there as he scampers for 16 yards.
Ball spotted down at the 29-yard line. Wilton Spate asking for a change of play from the huddle. Harbaugh re-giving the signs.
Watch Darbo in single coverage out left.
Poggi in motion. High form. Smith the tailback. Toss play to Smith going right. Brought down in the backfield. Nice play getting through the line. Trey Watson, the onside linebacker, tackling him for a loss. Michigan loses five there on first down. It'll be second and 15. First negative play of the day for the Wolverines. And you know you're going well when it's already early in the second quarter before you have a negative play from scrimmage. Michigan 125 yards on the ground already today. Spade in the shotgun, looking left. Has a man across the field, that's Darbo. Makes the catch, high pointing the ball in coverage. Double coverage, I should say. And it'll be first and goal, Michigan, from the 7-yard line.
Fit that one into a tight window. Good job getting that ball into coverage. Darius Mosley was the man closest to him.
Hardy Nickerson on the tackle, coming from behind to cover the mistake. First and 10, Michigan from the 7. Or rather, first and goal, Michigan from the 7. Peppers in as the Wildcat. Fakes the give to Higdon, cuts left, tackled at the 4-yard line, 3 yards there, second and goal from the 4.
A lot of opportunities for Jabril Peppers to get that direct snap out of the Wildcat so far today. Has yet to really wow the fans here at the Big House. Still waiting for that moment. We know he is one of the most electric athletes in all of college football. But Illinois has done a good job at least of stymieing those tricky plays so far this afternoon.
Michigan goes back with a more conventional package. I form with Poggi, the fullback, and Smith, the tailback. Asiasi in motion. Hand off to Smith. Cuts up the middle, into the end zone. Touchdown, Wolverines! The fourth touchdown of the day for this Michigan squad. Second on the ground. And Michigan distributing the point across all of their offensive specials.
And that's the raw power that you get with Davion Smith, able to bust right up the gut and through the hole. I believe it was Stanley Green that was there to try and stop him at the goal line, and Davion Smith just plowing him over on his way to 6 points.
Davion Smith sometimes has the looks of a semi-truck keeping those wheels turning. It's hard to stop that momentum, but even once you've stopped the momentum, he can regain it pretty quickly. Kenny Allen tacks on the extra point for Northern Michigan, up 28-0. And we're still 11 minutes to go till halftime. This Michigan team up 4 scores at home. And you'd expect that to be an impressive output so far, but Michigan still has 10 points to cover the spread in this one. They were 38.5 point favorites going into this 3:30 kick.
And I have to tell you, coming off of the game in Piscataway 2 weeks ago, this one feeling very Rutgers-esque in its beatdown style. Here during our TV timeout, it looks like there's going to be a special video shown on the board. Larry Prout, young boy, I believe with cerebral palsy, given an offer to join the Michigan football team this week, a really heartwarming story. I believe he's 13 years old. Jim Harbaugh inviting him to join the team.
A make-a-wish type experience for the young man.
Looks like he's down in the north end zone underneath the field goal posts, along with a cadre of family and coaches.
We got an opportunity to be at a press conference with the Wolverines this week, meet everybody on the team, attend practice.
And that's really cool. You like to see that.
So we'll quickly reset you with the statistics on that scoring drive. The Wolverines, 8 plays, 62 yards, 3:50 off the clock. They've dominated the time of possession today, nearly tripling up Illinois today. 14 minutes of possession to this 4:55 for Illinois. Wolverines, 262 total yards, 132 on the ground, 130 in the air for Wilton-Spate, 8 of 10 on the day. His passer rating, an impressive 255.
And there down at the 5-yard line is Larry Prout Jr., exciting the crowd with his Michigan M gloves and his Jim Harbaugh sweatshirt and khakis, tipping his cap to the crowd before returning to his family inside the end zone.
So if you're Lovie Smith, you're down 28-0, you're on the road, you're 2-4, it's season one. What do you need to do to get your players fired back up and perhaps get a moral victory to build the rest of your season off of here against Michigan on their homecoming day?
Well, it's like what we were talking about in Rutgers last week or 2 weeks ago, was just the need for one of those spark plays that puts a little bit of confidence back into your offense. It's a 10, 15-yard run. It's a 20-yard pass. It's something that gets this team going just a little bit, shows that this Michigan defense is not as invincible as they claim they are. They got the first down, which was something that eluded Rutgers until the fourth quarter, but points would be nice in any way, shape, or form.
And for Rutgers, their big play was a pick six that ultimately got called back. On the return for Illinois is Kendrick Foster. He's tackled at about the 14-yard line. He fielded the ball right at the goal line. And a tough return there, tough field position to start for Illinois. Trying to get things going. They have 13 yards on the ground today. They have not completed a pass, so those 13 yards are their only yards. Here, already having played 20 minutes of football.
Statistic from Morris Fabry, our Twitter spotter. Michigan at this point has scored 113 unanswered points.
Impressive. Particularly from a team with an iffy passing game here in the Big Ten. As we mentioned earlier, 8th in the Big Ten in terms of passing yards. Toss play on first down to Foster. He's met near the line of scrimmage on the edge. And now the man on the tackle.
Tackled by Ben Gideon.
Gideon also in there for the Wolverines. 2 yards there gained on first down. Rather, 4 yards there on first down. Second and 6 from the 19. Jeff George Jr. looking towards the sideline, getting the play call. He communicates the play to his line. Now goes out in the Wildcat. It's Keyshawn Vaughn as the Wildcat. Man in motion, Tyler White. Vaughn takes it himself. Cuts across the middle, onto the right side, up the sideline. Jabril Peppers in pursuit, pushes him out of bounds near Michigan's 30-yard line. A big run there for Keyshawn Vaughn, the longest of the day for this Illinois team, and that will move them into the black yardage-wise.
And that's the spark that I was talking about, Eli, a play that'll get this Illinois offense a bit of confidence going forward. They're going to spot it at the Michigan 36-yard line, pretty close to field goal range.
45-yard gain there. Ball placed at the 36-yard line.
45-yard run officially in the book.
George under center. Fakes the give. Looking downfield to the left side. Has a man across the middle. Nearly picked off by Channing Stribling. He is about as angry as one can be at themselves. But nevertheless, gets the pass breakup on a near interception. And it'll be second and 10 from the 36. Channing Stribling, that would have been his third pick on the season.
Played that coverage perfectly on Dominic Thiemann. And Channing Stribling, Jordan Lewis really the one that gets all the national praise, but Stribling has been strong in his role at cornerback this season.
Fakes the give. That's Vaughn faking the give to Corbin. Vaughn takes it himself. Runs forward for 2 yards. It'll be third and 8 from the 34.
And a stop here for Michigan would put Illinois in an interesting situation, whether or not they would decide to go for the long, long field goal or maybe even look to go on fourth down.
Big Sean down on the Michigan sideline being shown on the big board. Did not attend Michigan, but a lifelong Michigan fan. Jeff George moves into the Wildcat. Keyshawn Vaughn takes it himself. Across the line of scrimmage, brought down from behind. Flag on the play, looks like a hold from the weak side of the play. Sean Gary, the tackle. Vaughn is still down on the field. Taco Charlton giving attention to the injured man, making sure he's all right.
Holding offense, number 53, 10-yard penalty, repeat third down. Officials timeout for injured offensive player.
Nick Allegretti, the left guard for Illinois, called for the hold. And Keyshawn Vaughn still down right there at the 35-yard line. Illinois' training staff giving him attention.
A series of coaches down next to him, as well as number 71, Joe Spencer, his center.
And that would be a big loss for this team if Vaughn is unable to return to the game. We've seen him almost more and more snaps under center than Jeff George, the starting quarterback today. And while this Illinois offense hasn't been spectacular, he is a huge dimension to this team.
He is
not walking on that left leg as he
a lot of aid. That left leg swinging a yard above the grass, not an ounce of weight on it. And that does not look good for Illinois and Keyshawn Vaughn.
So it'll be 3rd and 17 for Illinois from the 43-yard line on Michigan's side of the field.
I'd imagine this would be a coffin corner punt situation that definitely takes them out of field goal range. They'd be looking at a 60-yarder.
Illinois still has one down to try and pick up some extra yardage, bring them closer to field goal range. They are kicking into the wind if they do decide to attempt that field goal. Down on the field there, honoring the Michigan women's gymnastics team, Big Ten championships last year, 2016.
A lot of Big Ten championship teams being honored here today. During the tunnel entrance pregame as well, every 2006 and 2010, I believe, Big Ten individual champion going through and hitting the Michigan banner. wind is still pushing heavily as well against Illinois.
Ready to go here on the field. 8:40 to go on the clock here in the second quarter. Jeff George looking at a 3rd and 17. He's lost his primary Wildcat back in Keyshawn Vaughn. Reggie Corbin, the tailback, playing from under center. Surprising given the down and distance. Hand off to Corbin. Cuts left. Trying to find the edge. Nearly brought down by Jordan Lewis. In and out of his hands, but Taco Charlton is able to finally record the tackle near the 38-yard line. It would be a 55-yard attempt into a 15-mile-an-hour wind for this Illinois team. So we're going to see the punting unit, Ryan Frayne, the man.
Going to try and pin Jabril Peppers back deep in his own territory.
Gets the punt off. It was tipped on the last possession, you'll recall. Nearly bounces and hits Delano Hill. Very dangerous play there. Delano Hill downfield blocking, and it almost hit him on his backside. Illinois downs the punt at the 8-yard line. Michigan escapes a difficult situation there. Delano Hill is going to get an earful from Chris Partridge, special teams coordinator for this Wolverine squad.
7:34 remaining here in the first half. Michigan leading 28-0 over the Illinois Fighting Illini here at the Big House. Take a moment to give you a couple more scores from around college football. Currently the number one team in the country, the Alabama Crimson Tide, up 13-0 on number 6, Texas A&M. That one with a little over 5 minutes remaining in the first half. Over in the Big Ten, Indiana losing to Northwestern by a score of 24-14 earlier today. In-state rivalry going on right now between the number 20 undefeated Western Michigan Broncos and PJ Fleck against the Eastern Michigan Eagles, looking to get bowl eligibility today with the upset. That one's 14-7 in favor of the Broncos with 10:55 remaining in the first half. Other games going on right now, number 22, North Carolina, up 14-7 on unranked Virginia. Purdue, who fired their coach Daryl Hazel last week, currently lead the number 8 Nebraska Cornhuskers 14-10 in Lincoln. Upset alert there late in the first half. Right now, Memphis is tied with number 24 Navy at 14-all. TCU and number 12 West Virginia, 21-10 in favor of the Mountaineers. Number 19, the Utah Utes, and the UCLA Bruins. That one's tied at 14-all towards the end of the first quarter. A couple other Big Ten scores from earlier this morning. Number 10, Wisconsin, hanging on for a close win against Iowa, 17-9 in Iowa City. And a couple big games looming tonight. Ohio State will have Under the Lights in Happy Valley against the Penn State Nittany Lions. Ohio State, the number 2 team in the nation. A big bottom-ranked battle between number 23 Ole Miss and number 25 LSU at 9 p.m. in Baton Rouge.
The Wolverines will get things going here from their own 8-yard line. This is by far their worst starting field position of the day. Three men in the backfield for the Wolverines. They're all heavy men. Davion Smith gets the give going right. Had a big hole, but they're sealing that hole. Is Darius Mosley. He's brought down for about 3 yards on first down. They'll call it for 2nd and 6 from the 11-yard line.
Watch Michigan to go to the air here. Both Amara Darbo and J.U. Chesson coming off the sideline. Going to split out wide to the left.
Spate from the gun. Asiasi in motion to the right side. Damian Smith moves over with him, looking for some pass protection. Quick pass. He has Darbo across the middle. Hit as he comes down with it. He gets to the 25-yard line, another Michigan first down, and they're out from the shadow of their own end zone.
And that's just a perfectly played slant route from Amara Darbo and a good spot-on throw from Wilton Spate in the mid-range to get Michigan out of the shadow of their own goal line. 14 yards on the first down pass.
Handoff on first down. It's Smith running to the right side. Brought down as he crossed the line of scrimmage. Picks up 2 yards. Stanley Green on the tackle.
Michigan plugging away time here towards the end of the first half. It has been all maize and blue here so far in Ann Arbor.
Second and 8 from the 27. Wolverines with 2 in the backfield. Higdon, fake give. Darbo across the right side. He makes the catch, but he's brought down just in front of the line to the gain. It'll be 3rd and 1.
Julian Jones on the stop along.
An identical slant route that we saw 2 plays ago, this one for shorter yardage, but Julian Jones still struggling to get that inside edge on Amara Darbo out wide on the left.
Amara Darbo a little bit slow to get up and then ran off the field but looked a little bit gimpy. They're going to take a look at his lower half down there. Michigan eye form on 3rd and 1. Higdon up the middle. Didn't get there on the first effort, but he looked like he got the push from behind. Thanks to Ben Bredesen.
They are signaling for first down.
Ben Bredesen coming in from behind the left guard today, pushing his man forward, getting Caron Higdon that first down. Wolverines will be 1st and 10 from the 35. 5:05 left to go here in this first half of play. The Wolverines up 28-0 on the Fighting Illini of the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. Lots of motion on the line for the Wolverines. Chesson in motion. Gets the handoff on an end around. They read it well, though. Only picks up about 6 yards. Not able to cut upfield. Jalen Dunlap on the tackle, that corner, making the play.
And a well-run play. Kikoa Crawford was out wide to the left. Downfield for the block, but Chesson just unable to get that edge and get downfield. Good play on the right-hand side and a nice tackle made by Jalen Dunlap.
Wolverines continuing to eat up time off the clock. 4.5 to go in the first half. Fakes the give to Smith, looking right. Downfield, he has Chesson wide open. Underthrew it, and Chesson had to dive to make the play. Unable to turn upfield after that one. But the Wolverines pick up the first down across midfield. It'll be 1st and 10 from the 46-yard line for the Wolverines. A 14-yard completion. And now Michigan goes big with Jabril Peppers in at the Wildcat. See if he can do something dynamic. Fakes the give to Higdon, running right, men in the backfield, and nearly brought down for a loss. Spins out of a tackle, but they'll finally get him as he ran towards the edge. Jalen Dunlap on the tackle. Every time Jabril Peppers has been in today, the misdirection hasn't worked for them. He hasn't been able to turn anything big upfield.
And maybe Michigan not showing too much out of the playbook in terms of the Wildcat, but if anything, that's a testament to how difficult it is to bring Jabril Peppers down. Took a whole cadre of Illinois Fighting Illini.
And the man who made the tackle, Jalen Dunlap, still down there near the Michigan sideline, receiving attention from Illinois' training staff. A lot of injuries so far today. Another important score that you did not mention from out of town, Colorado up 7-3 at the farm in Palo Alto. That would be a big win for Michigan's resume. Our own Will Yang getting ready to call the second half. He's rooting for Stanford, a Palo Alto native. But in any case, Seifo Luau.
That was a good Colorado team that Michigan
absolutely
played here in Ann Arbor.
People were not expecting them to be as good as they ended up being, and now Michigan fans will joke that 10-2 is still on the table, but if they're able to pull off this victory against Stanford, that's the last really big test on their schedule prior to, of course, a potential Big 12 matchup in a championship game against the University of Washington. Spade under center, 2nd and 13. Davion Smith, the tailback. Fakes the give to him, looking deep downfield and unable to get the throw off in time. Tackled in the backfield, a sack by Carroll Phillips. The pass protection broke down Davion Smith unable to get that block level.
I do like that Spate decided not to try and force the throw. He just held on to the ball and took the hit.
And so the
Wolverines will go 3rd and 22 from their own 42, getting pushed back behind their own side of midfield. The wind is waving heavily, picking up just a little bit these last couple minutes. Two split out wide on each side, looking for a quick dump down. Davion Smith tripped up as he tried to make the catch. There was quick pressure. Dialing up the blitz was Illinois' defense. And Michigan is going to punt for the first time today.
Illinois can put that in their cap. They stop the Wolverines just before halftime here with 2:35 left in the first half.
But I should point out, Illinois does need to get a few first downs here. Otherwise, Michigan will have the ball with plenty of time to go.
Darius Mosley,
the man back to return for Illinois. Kenny Allen, low line drive. Mosley's going to have an opportunity to return this one. He runs left, across the 25, across the 30, hit there, Ben Gedeon. And Mosley, another man who I didn't quite see the number, bring him down. Other tackler for the Wolverines, Nick Eubanks.
Michigan has just one timeout left, Illinois with all three. If Illinois wanted to burn that clock and keep the ball off the sidelines.
2:24 on the clock for Illinois. They have 70 yards to go to bring this one home. Jeff George in the backfield. Has one man to his right. Quick pressure. And the pass is picked off. Coming in there, DeMonte Thomas. A quick dump off by Jeff George. Trying to get the ball away as Michigan had dialed up the blitz. And undercutting the route. Real heads up play by DeMonte Thomas. To pick that pass off. It was intended. We didn't even have time to change our rosters.
Thomas returned the ball to the 25-yard line. First and 10, Michigan.
Intended for Kendrick Foster, perhaps. But nevertheless, 2:17 on the clock for the Wolverines and a very short field setting up at the 25-yard line.
Looks like they're calling an official's timeout right now.
An injured player. Looks like a Michigan Wolverine down there on the sideline. Tyree Cannell, the man down there. He's 5 yards off the field near the 20-yard line.
Up and now limping over to the bench. See if play resumes here as Cannell going to take a seat at the trainer's table.
So Michigan first and 10 from the 25. High form. Smith the ball. Hit near the line, taken down for a 1 yard gain.
Davion Smith, the ball carrier.
Now Michigan with a great opportunity to put even more points on the board before half. Already up 4 touchdowns.
Smith stays in the game, single setback. Kind of a loose trips right, and now Jake Butt comes out further wide. Hand off to Smith, he has a lot of room on the left side. Nice blocking there by Ben Braden on the left side, and the Michigan Wolverines pick up the first down, moving forward to near the 10-yard line. We'll see if they call it goal to go. They will indeed, first and goal for the Wolverines. From the 10-yard line.
The 10-yard line, first and goal, Michigan.
I form tight for the Wolverines. Asiasi on the right side. Now he moves a little bit further inside. Hand off to Smith. He bobbled the ball on the handoff. able to regain control, barrels forward. 6 yards there. Michigan has the ball. Second and goal from the four.
And that was a difficult handoff. Illinois burst right through the offensive line and disrupted that transfer between Spate and Smith. And a good job by Smith to control himself and barrel forward to the 5 yard line.
Darius Mosley, a nice tackle there, getting off his man to prevent the Michigan touchdown, at least for the time being. Hand off to Smith, up the middle, met at the line, tries to spin out of it, continues moving. He's down near the 1 yard line. They're going to mark it down at the 2. 40 seconds left on the clock here in the first half, and now the big man, Colin Hill, comes into the game. Already has a touchdown on the day. Leads this Michigan team with 8 touchdowns on the year.
8 touchdowns on just 14 carries. This is where he thrives. Can he make it 9 on 15?
Michigan third and goal from the 2 yard line. Toss play to the right side. Smith trying to cut up field. Matt in the backfield, brought down by Jalen Dunlap.
Damian Smith, the ball carrier. Jalen Dunlap. Tackle for a loss.
Timeout. Michigan, their third and final timeout. 30-second timeout.
So Michigan with 3 left on the clock here in the half. They call a timeout. We'd expect Kenny Allen to be the man for the Wolverines. Looking for the points here, up 28-0 here at halftime. Then again, 2 weeks ago, Michigan really enjoyed running up the score on Rutgers. We could see them go for it. And Kenny Allen is going to come out for the Wolverines. Wind blowing now in his face. At least the American flag is blowing north. The flags near the end zone appear a little bit more undecided. Wind whipping around in any case, down on the field. Snap, hold is good, the kick is up, and the kick is good. The Wolverines tack on a field goal. It's 31-0 as these two teams head to the locker room. And for Illinois, you gotta imagine, they're just looking for something to hang their hats on at this point. Down 31-0 on the road, Michigan enjoying their homecoming weekend. And they'll go to the homecoming halftime show, a tradition here in Michigan. Jeremy, your thoughts on the first half as Illinois just has 70 rushing yards on the day, no passing yards to their credit as Jeff George Jr. has yet to complete a pass.
Michigan's defense continues to be the statistically best defense in the country. No yards given up in the passing game. Jeff George was 0-7. And then in the run game, 11 rushes for 70 yards. Michigan also getting the interception towards the end of the first half there. And that's pretty much set the tone. The Michigan offense has spread the wealth both in the air and on the ground. And that is how we will end the first half with Michigan up 31-0. Welcome back into the University of Michigan Stadium here in Ann Arbor, Michigan. I'm Leo Blavin. Will Yang joining me as we get you set for the second half between the third-ranked Michigan Wolverines and the Illinois Fighting Illini. Michigan leads it 31-0. Illinois will start with the football to start the second half. Will, what has to change offensively for Illinois to get back in this game?
Well, Illinois made their mark on big plays, and we saw one big play from the running back, Keyshawn Vaughn, in the second quarter. Illinois has four runs of 50-plus yards this season, tied for the third most in the nation. Lovie Smith, if he wants to get back into this game, he has to hit some home run plays. He has to flip the field quickly if he wants to catch up down 31-0. And Malik Turner, their big receiver, possibly the best player on Illinois' offense, hasn't been involved at all. He's been non-existent. In fact, the passing game has completely been non-existent. No completions have been made on for Illinois quarterback Jeff George Jr. So I think a more balanced attack for Lovie Smith's offense, as well as hitting some more big plays.
There will be a strong wind at the back of Kenny Allen as he gets set to kick off the second half. Michigan on top 31-0. The Wolverines routing the Illini through the first half. It's the first ever meeting between two former Super Bowl head coaches as college head coaches. Lovie Smith manning the sideline for Illinois. Of course, Jim Harbaugh, the leader of the Maize and Blue.
Yeah, interesting you mentioned Lovie Smith. Went to the Super Bowl with the Chicago Bears. Had one of the best defenses, just a really dominant team that year with Rex Grossman as the quarterback. And Lovie Smith is definitely a very experienced coach. And I know Illinois hasn't really had the best season yet. But I think he can definitely turn the franchise around.
Allen kicks it off from the right hash marks with a strong wind in his back. He'll take advantage. This one sails out of the end zone. Touchback to start this second half for Illinois. They'll start this drive at their own 25-yard line.
First and 10, Illinois.
And it'll be Jeff George still out there in this game looking for his first completion. He was 0-for-7 through the air in the first half. Illinois total yardage, as you'd expect, not much. 70 yards, all of it coming on the ground, and most of it coming on a 45-yard run from Keyshawn Vaughn. In the shotgun, Kendrick Foster to the right of George. Tight end in motion from right to left. George gives to Vaughn. Vaughn cutting across the numbers out on the left side and picking up 2 yards, wrapped up by Ben Gedion.
Yeah, Illinois trying to establish that run game early. Lovie Smith still looking for that big play. And out of the read option, pick up quick short gain of 2 yards.
Out wide to the right, Malik Turner, Justin Hardy out wide to the left. Under center is George's. Jeff George looking to the sideline for the play call. Nate Eckert in as the fullback, offset eye. The tailback, Kendrick Foster. They'll snap it from the left hash mark. Second down, they give to Foster, cutting back up the middle. Taco Charlton wrapped him up, but a good cutback. Picks up another 2 yards. Demonte Thomas, who closed out the first half with an interception, in there for the tackle as well.
Illinois sticking with the run on second down, trying to help out their inexperienced quarterback. One thing about Illinois' offense is that they have a lot of different running backs they can use, and this can really help them survive the length of 60 minutes of a game. But I think here, third and long, they have to hit the air if they want to convert.
Third down and 4, Illinois with the ball at their own 31-yard line. 13:40 left to go in this third quarter. George's steps back, not a lot of pressure. Now he's forced to roll out to the left side, looking to pick up the first down with his legs, unable to do so. Ryan Glasgow chased him out of bounds, bailed on any sort of throw there, and that's really a good play by the secondary for Michigan, forcing Illinois to punt. It'll be fourth down and 2 with the ball at their own 33-yard line, which means the Roe Peppers will have another opportunity for a punt return in this one.
Yeah, great overall defensive play. Secondary locked everyone down. Jeff George really didn't have anywhere to go. Ryan Glasgow had some penetration and forced him out. And like Leo said, we'll see if Jabril has a chance to make a big play here on the punt.
Peppers lined up at his own 28. Ryan Frayne, the punter, fields it. It's a line drive kick returnable for Peppers if he elects to do so. He does not. He lets it bounce, and it will be downed by one of the gunners for Illinois. Zarian Holcomb gets down there first, and Michigan will start this first drive
on offense in this second half at their own 24-yard line with 12:55 left to go in the third quarter. It's Michigan 31, Illinois nothing. What led to Michigan's success early and often in the first half?
I think Wilton Spade did a good job of hitting his receivers downfield as well as execution in the red zone. Lovie Smith loves to run that cover too. And nine different rushers have touched the ball for Michigan. So this is classic Jim Harbaugh, spread the wealth, and it's been successful in the first half.
Two tight ends, Jake Butt on the left, Tyrone Wheatley Jr. on the right. Play action on first down for Spade. Has all the time in the world. Fires it to America's tight end, Jake Butt, across the 35. Gets down at the 39-yard line. A 14-yard pickup on first to 10. Moves the chains for the Maize and Blue.
Yeah, Jim Harbaugh exploited a mismatch there. Darius Mosley is Illinois' best cover guy, but he was matched up against Jake Butt and man-to-man. Spade saw that, and it was an easy pickup for the first down.
Michigan will snap it from the left hash mark at their own 39-yard line. Trips out wide to the right. Second down delay, give to Smith. Running to the left side, gets out to the left side, numbers across the 50, across the 45. Tackled from behind in Illinois territory at the 44-yard line. Ben Braden with a nice block there, playing left tackle in this game, and he's really impressed thus far.
Yeah, that was an interesting play. It looked like Illinois' defensive line got a lot of penetration, but they got too deep behind the backfield, and Davion Smith had lots of green in front of him to pick up another Michigan first down.
Back in Illinois territory is this Michigan offense. Out wide to the right is Amara Darbo. In the slot to the right, J.U. Chesson, Ty Isaac, the tailback, Pogge, the fullback. Play action. Spate all the time firing it deep for Chesson, who seemed to bail on his route early. It was a good throw by Spate, but it falls to the turf incomplete. Second and 10 coming up.
Yeah, if there's one area in his game that Wilton Spate needs to work on, is his deep ball. He hasn't really been able to hit that consistently, and this was a pretty good throw, but it looked like Chesson started, got off to a slow start. He threw it a bit deep, so it wasn't really playable by either Chesson or the cover guy, and that was Darius Mosley on the coverage.
Just
there.
The fourth incompletion of the game thus far for Spate. Second down and 10 from the left hash marked in Illinois territory. Ty Isaac takes the handoff, running the left side along the Illinois sideline across the 35. Has the shoulder lowered on him by Stanley Green at the 29-yard line. And a nice 16-yard scamper there for Ty Isaac.
Yeah, great job by the left side of the line, getting to that second level, engaging on linebackers. And that gave Ty Isaac plenty of room to run. And it looks like Illinois' best defensive player, DeJuan Smoot, was shaken up on the play. He's walking off to the sideline now, being intended by the training staff.
Yeah, DeJuan Smoot came into this year as Pro Football Focus's 20th-ranked player in the country, and certainly we'll be seeing him play on Sundays as he heads off to the sideline here. First and 10 for the Wolverines, and this play absolutely stuffed. Ben Braden, Mason Cole getting blown up at the point of attack. Ty Isaac dropped for a loss of 2 yards. Jameel President in there for Illinois. It'll be second and 14 after the loss on first down.
Yeah, I think Kalis was in on that too, and one of the interior linemen completely whiffed, and President was right there to make the tackle for loss.
From the middle of the field, second down and officially 12 now, as they correct it on the scoreboard. From the Illinois 31, Michigan on top, 31-0. Play action. Spate fires it deep down the left side of the field as Amara Darbo, who cannot hang on. It was a well-placed ball, but good coverage by Darius Mosley, who's slow to get up. But a nice throw there, just Darbo can't help out his quarterback. Third down and 12 upcoming.
Yeah, very good throw by Spade. I mentioned he struggled throwing the deep ball throughout the season, but this was a very well-placed ball. There looked like there could have been some pass interference. The crowd's pretty upset, but Darius Mosley's a very good cover cornerback, and you got to give credit for him for making that pass breakup on a very well-placed ball.
Chesson out wide to the right in the slot is Drake Harris. Out wide to the left is Kikoa Crawford. Spate looking to throw, and he elects to hang on to it as he's brought down for a sack. Jameel President and Hardy Nickerson both in there to drop Spate. Surprised he didn't pull the trigger on that one. And now Michigan in an interesting position. That's not a sack Michigan can really afford to take, and they will have to punt because of it. It'll be fourth and 20. Spate really needed to get rid of that football. Michigan now forced to punt.
Yeah, this is a tricky position for Michigan on Illinois' 40-yard line. It'll be a tough punt for Kenny Allen.
And he has a strong wind at his back, good snap, and he pooches this one high into the air. It does not take a particularly favorable bounce for Michigan. It sort of checks up at the 15-yard line, and that is where Illinois will start their second drive of this second half, trailing 31-0 with 10-10 still to play in this third quarter on the Michigan Football Student Radio Network, WCBN-FM Ann Arbor. I'm Leo Blavin. Joining me, Will Yang. Will, what did you see from Michigan on that offensive drive that got stalled in Illinois territory?
I think Illinois' secondary did a great job of covering receivers downfield. It looked like they were in a lot of man coverage, and they did a great job of keeping up with both Chesson and Darba, who are Michigan's fastest receivers. I think if you're Michigan, the run game was going well. Illinois got a few stops that put them in second and third and long. And Illinois' defense, that's exactly where you want to put them, and they forced another punt. Michigan was forced to start in their own territory pretty deep around the 20-yard line, and the last time Illinois forced Michigan to punt, they were also deep. So the field position battle could be a factor going further into this game.
Coming into this afternoon's game, Michigan's defense led the country in scoring defense, total defense, pass defense, sacks, first downs allowed, and third down conversion rate. It's been the same throughout this game. Illinois 1-for-6 on third down, just 77 total yards, and they have yet to find the end zone. What's made Michigan's defense so special in this game specifically?
I think it's just been a lot of great team football from all 11 guys involved in the defense. Starting with the secondary, they've been able to lock down Illinois' receivers, especially Malik Turner. Again, I mentioned this at the beginning, the second half, Illinois' best offensive player, one of the best receivers in the country, a very big physical receiver that can make plays, especially in the red zone down the field. And Michigan, whoever they've thrown at them, have been able to keep covered. And if the passing game's not open, Illinois has to stick to the run. They had that one big play that was, I guess, a mistake on Michigan's defense, but overall Michigan has been smothering that run game, so there really hasn't been any options for Lovie Smith's offense.
When we come back, it'll be first and 10 for Illinois at their own 15-yard line, 10-10 still to go in this third quarter, Michigan leading 31-0. Still waiting to get out of this TV timeout. Surprised that Jeff George remains in this game, Will, given his 0-for-7 start through the air, and seemingly Illinois' unwillingness to have him under center most of this game. We've seen a ton of Keyshawn Vaughn as the Wildcat quarterback, not a lot of passing threats, and with Keyshawn Vaughn out, you have to expect that George is going to be the lone man receiving direct snaps the remainder of this game if Illinois elects to keep him in at quarterback.
Well, this is Jeff George's first start as quarterback, so I think Lovie Smith is trying to get him some experience.
Kendrick Foster will be the tailback on first and 10. Illinois snapping it from the right hash marks. In motion, Malik Turner now out wide to the right. It's a pitch to Vaughn running to the left side, gets across the hash marks, across the 15, across the 18-yard line, brought down at the 19. Kendrick Foster with a nice pickup sets up second down and 5.
The thing I really like about all of Illinois' running backs is that they're all very patient. They have very high football IQs. They're able to wait for the linemen to make holes. And that was a nice gain of 4 on first down. I think if the running backs are able to continue to be patient, we could see them move down the field more effectively.
Kendrick Foster in there once again on second down and 6 from the Illinois 19. George takes the snap, quickly fires it out to the right. It's a screen pass for Malik Turner. Needs to make a few men miss. He does, but Mike McCray wrapped him up after picking up just a yard. Delano Hill had a chance to really blow that play up, but good elusiveness by Malik Turner to turn nothing into something.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that was a pass. It looked pretty parallel to the line of scrimmage, but if it was, it was the first completion by Jeff Jordan Jr. all day. He had no completions in the first half, so although it was only a gain of 1 yard, possibly a good confidence boost for Jeff George in his first start as quarterback.
And we'll wait to see how they officially record that one. In the meantime, third down and 6. Illinois with the ball at their own 19. Trips wide to the left, one out wide to the right. George takes the snap, steps back, looking to throw, firing it deep over the middle of the field. And the catch is made by Turner across the 50. And a shoestring tackle made by Ben Gedeon, but a big mismatch there. The wideout matched up with a middle linebacker, and Illinois takes advantage, gets the ball all the way down to the Michigan 38.
That's exactly what I was saying that Lovie Smith needed to do for this offense. Get the best player on your field the ball, make him make a play, let him make a play, a big play, and now Illinois all of a sudden is in Michigan territory.
And they did rule that last screen throw as a backward pass, so it was a run. There is your first completion of the game for Jeff George Jr., and he picks up 43 yards thanks to the Nice receiving play by Malik Turner. First and 10 from the Michigan 38 for the Illini, looking for their first score of the game. George on a quick slant route finds Zach Grant. Cutting across the middle, picking up 5 yards, second and 5 upcoming.
That's two completions in a row, or three if you're counting the backward screen as a pass. Jeff, if you're Jeff George right now, you got to like the confidence that you have now, that hitting two receivers in stride perfectly, and now you're marching down Michigan territory.
The freshman from Indianapolis starting to find his rhythm. Bunched receivers split out wide to both sides. Kendrick Foster to the right of George in the shotgun. The give is to Foster cutting up the middle. Chris Wormley wrapped him up, but not before picking up 8 yards and a first down all the way down to the Michigan 25.
Now that the passing game has picked up for Illinois, now that they had more of a balanced offense, they've shown the defense that opens up the run game because they have to respect the passing game more. It looked like they were in man coverage, so fewer of the defensive backs were able to help out and run, and it was a nice run by Foster there to pick up the first down.
The fullback for Illinois, Nate Eckerd. The tailback, once again, Kendrick Foster. Out wide to the right is Dominic Thiemann and Malik Turner. Bad snap, the ball is on the ground. As Michigan has it, they say they do, and they do! Mike McCray came up with the football. And just when Illinois looks to be threatening Michigan's shutout streak, a bad snap from Joe Spencer to Jeff George is muffed. Mike McCray falls on it, and Michigan forces their second turnover of the game.
It's possibly the most deflating thing that could happen to Illinois. You're finally getting some momentum, gaining ground deep into Michigan territory, and just a very stupid mistake shows the inexperience of Jeff George's first career start, fumbling the snap, just lack of discipline there, I don't know, but just a really dumb mistake to kill all the momentum you created to start out the second half, and now Michigan gets the ball back, and now deep in their own territory, but this is their chance maybe to put the game away with this drive.
And it really is a shame. Just Illinois flat out has not played that well in this game, and it would have been nice to see, especially with their freshman quarterback making his first start, to get a score on the road at the Big House. Of course, George used to these expectations, even though it's his first career start. He's the son of the number one overall draft pick. Yes, that Jeff George, the former Illini quarterback who went number one overall in the NFL draft back in 1990, started his career with the Colts, played 10 years as a signal caller in the NFL. George, not highly touted, his son, I should say, Jeff George Jr., not highly touted out of Warren Central High School. He was just a two-star recruit, elected to go to Illinois, walk on the team, and he's getting his first start in a very hostile environment. Seemed to be finding a rhythm on that last drive, but it's all for naught as Mike McCray falls on the botched snap, and Michigan gets their second turnover of the game.
Yeah, Jeff George Jr. showing a lot of potential on the last drive. Hit three perfect throws, honestly, and Michigan's defense didn't really have any answer for those throws, and it seemed like Illinois was starting to put something together, but then his inexperience showed. He buffed the snap. Not sure whether it was his fault or the center's fault, but either way, you have to convert, especially if you're going up against one of the best defenses, if not the best defenses, of Michigan, and now Michigan's going to take over, and Illinois might not even have a chance to get back to where they were, given how this game has been going.
It'll be first and 10 at the 27 after the Mike McCray fumble recovery gives the ball back to the Maize and Blue offense. Wilton Spate still out there. Davion Smith will be his running back. Henry Hoji, the fullback.
And it looks like DeJuan Smoot, who was shaken up on the previous defensive drive, is back out there, about to line up at the left defensive end. One of the best defenders in the country. Good to see him healthy.
Michigan will snap this one between the hash marks. Wilton Spate will be under center. Davion Smith dotting the eye with Poggi, the fullback. Amara Darbo out wide to the left. J.U. Chesson out wide to the right. Jake Butt and Tyrone Wheatley Jr., the two tight ends. Davion Smith looking to run behind them, but that play was absolutely blown up by Chunky Clements.
Brought down by Chunky Clements.
Yeah, what a name. I got to love that. Chunky Clements made a great play. Got off the block quickly, and he was able to beat Davion Smith right in the backfield.
It's a loss of two on the run by Smith.
Loss of two on the play at second and 12.
a rare sight. Currently Michigan 180 yards through the air, 171 on the ground. Rarely you see this Michigan offense being led by the passing game. That's the case today as they lead it 31-0 with 6:20 to go. Flags come out before the snap here, and I believe it will be a full start. Let's go down to the field and see what Ron Snodgrass, today's referee, has to say.
False start, offense, number 86, 5-yard penalty, repeat second down.
J.U. Chesson out there, picking up the 5-yard infraction, a bit antsy before the snap, and second and 12 turns into second and 17. Michigan will snap this one from their own 21-yard line, leading it 31-0 with 6:45 and counting left to go in this third quarter between the third-ranked Wolverines and the Fighting Illini.
Yeah, run for a loss and a penalty to start out this drive. Not really what you want for Jim Harbaugh.
Chesson in motion from left to right. Darbo out wide to the left. Play action. Spate steps up looking for Chesson over the middle. Catches it near midfield. Loses the ball as he goes to the turf. They're going to rule it a fumble. And Illinois, I believe, fell onto it. But now the referees come in. Cooler heads prevail, and they rule that J.U. Chesson was down before losing the football. So instead of a turnover, it will be a first down on the 20-yard connection from Spate to Chesson. Julian Jones is the man who dove on the football for Illinois, but they did rule Chesson down, and Michigan hurries to the line. Don't want to see this play reviewed. Drake Harris out wide to the right, Darbo out wide to the left. Lovey Smith has yet to exit the field. Harbaugh wanted to get the snap off. It appeared Michigan did. Lovey Smith never left the field. So perhaps he's electing to take a timeout.
Rolling on the field was a completed catch. And the runner was down. The play's under further review.
Now it looked from our vantage point like Michigan got the snap off. Lovey Smith just never left the field for Illinois. So a bit of gamesmanship showing his experience as a head coach, not letting him get that snap off. And it left enough time for Ron Snodgrass to get the buzz on the hip, indicating that they will take another look at this.
Yeah, that shows the experience of Lovey Smith. You know, if they win this challenge or the review goes Illinois' favor, this could be a turnover, and Illinois could start right back where they started. If they can score and make it 31-7, Illinois is right back in this game. So Lovey Smith knows the importance of this play, and got to be honest, a lot of coaches in college football won't be aware or just wouldn't be aware enough in that situation to try to fight for that challenge and stop Michigan from running a play. Jim Harbaugh, another very experienced quarterback, knows what Lovey Smith is doing. He's trying to rush to the line and get the snap. So a lot of mind games from two very experienced coaches, and that's why they've been to a Super Bowl.
It's been an interesting chess match between the two head coaches. Obviously, the talent disparity was going to make this game ugly rather quickly, but like you were talking about as we open the second half, Lovey Smith appears to have this team headed in the right direction coming off their first Big Ten win under Smith.
The receiver did catch the ball, but fumbled, recovered by the defense. First down, Illinois at the 37-yard line.
So the call on the field is overturned. J.U. Chesson with Michigan's first turnover of the game, fumbling it upon after the reception. And Illinois takes over in Michigan territory, looking for their first points of the game, trailing 31-0 with 6:26. Left to go in the third quarter. You're listening to the Michigan Football Student Radio Network, WCBN FM, Ann Arbor.
And there we go. That was a classic mind game between two great head coaches, and it looks like Lovey Smith won that one. It's going to be Illinois' ball starting at the Michigan 37-yard line, knocking on that doorstep once more.
Michigan's starting defense still out there. First and 10 for Illinois from the Michigan 37-yard line. Jeff George still in at quarterback. He'll be in the shotgun with Kendrick Foster to his right. They give to Foster on first down. Taco Charlton wrapped him up at the line of scrimmage and got carried for 2 yards by Foster. Second and 8. Next.
Yeah, Foster was a running back on that play. Deshaun Vaughn, Illinois' best running back, has left the game with a knee injury, so that hurts Illinois' depth. But Foster and also Reggie Corman are both very capable running backs.
Nate Eckerd in as the fullback. Dotting the eye is Foster. George under center. The give to Foster. That blown up immediately, forced to cut back and makes something out of that one. DeMonte Thomas wrapped him up at the cleats, but not before Foster lowered the pad level and picked up 3 yards. Third and 3 upcoming.
Yeah, I mentioned on the last drive the vision that these running backs have, especially Foster. On that last play, Michigan had it completely blown up, but he was able to find a hole open up to the right, and he was able to take that play from a negative play to a gain of three, and now it's third and short for the Fighting Illini.
Third down and three. George rolling out to his right under heavy pressure. Delano Hill closed on that one quickly. It falls to the turf. Incomplete. And now decision time. Will, any reason for Illinois not to go for it here? It'll be fourth and three from the Michigan 30, and they're losing 31-0.
Yeah, I think you got to go for it, especially at this part of the field. It's definitely too short to punt, and I don't, depending on Illinois' kicker, probably too long for a field goal. So common sense, Lovie Smith knows it. It's time to go for it on fourth down.
Jeff George Jr. in the pistol. Fourth and three. Looking to the sidelines, the Michigan fans want the shutout. 5:09 to go in this third quarter. Michigan leading 31-0. Illinois threatening, though, to put points on the board. George bobbles the snap, but recovers. Has all the time in the world. Fires it. Intended for the running back. Foster, it falls. Incomplete. Ben Gedeon on the coverage. Tough for a linebacker to maintain coverage for that long, as there was just no pressure in George's face. Give Gedeon a ton of credit. It falls incomplete, and Michigan takes over on down.
Yeah, that was perfect coverage. They looked like Michigan had only a four-man rush, so George had plenty of time to make a throw, but everyone was covered downfield. Gedeon, like Leo said, was matched up man-to-man on the running back, and usually that's a win for the running back 9 out of 10 times, but Gedeon showed his athleticism, and he was able to make a great play to give Michigan the ball back.
5:02 left to go in the third quarter. Michigan leading at 31-0 over the Illinois Fighting Illini, as the third-ranked team in the country looking all that and more today. Let's see if Michigan's offense can get their first score of this second half.
Yeah, Michigan, the third-ranked team in the country, has not looked like it so far in the second half. The score is 0-0 in the third quarter, and both offenses have sputtered. Illinois has actually outplayed Michigan in terms of field position so far. And I think if you're Jim Harbaugh, you can't be happy with how the second half has started out. Illinois forced them to punt on their first drive, and then they committed a turnover with the J.U. Chesson fumble on the second drive. The defense has held their ground. They have continued the shutout. They have continued to shut out Illinois so far, but Jim Harbaugh wants to put some points on the board. Look for Michigan to be a bit more aggressive on this next drive.
Let's take this opportunity to update our listeners on some scores from around the country. Stanford in a barn burner with Colorado trailing 10-3 as the clock is winding down in the fourth quarter at the farm. North Carolina walloping Virginia 28-7. Eastern Michigan hanging in there with the 20th-ranked Western Michigan Broncos. A big rivalry game in the state of Michigan. That game just got underway in the second half. Eastern trailing 17-24. Texas A&M takes the lead over Alabama 14-13 with 11:57 still to play in the third quarter. Purdue hanging in there with Nebraska. It's 14-17 with 6:12 still to play in that third quarter. Back here at the Big House, Michigan leading it 31-0 with 5:02 still to play in this third quarter. It'll be Michigan first to 10 at their own 30-yard line after Illinois turns it over on down. Ann Arbor out wide to the left. Khalid Hill, the fullback, the offset eye, dotting it, Davion Smith. Asiasi and Jake Butt both in there as tight ends. Give to Smith, cuts up the middle. He doesn't get through the second wave of tacklers. Tripped up at the feet, and there's a flag down as well, and I think this is coming back.
Holding, offense, number two, 10-yard penalty.
And that's the freshman, Devin Asiasi, who was praised by many for his blocking performance 2 weeks ago against Rutgers. But the freshman making a freshman mistake there with the holding penalty pushes Michigan back first and 20 now at their own 20.
Yeah, immediately after the penalty, Asiasi is subbed out. Harbaugh probably has some strong words for him. Replacing him is the redshirt freshman, Tyrone Wheatley Jr.
At wide to the left, Darbo. Wide to the right is Eddie McDoom. Spate firing over the middle has Darbo. Catches it across the 40, across the 45. Breaks through another tackle and gets all the way down to midfield. The right hash mark is where his knee hits the turf. And Michigan, with a huge connection there, a 30-yard pass from Spate to Darbo.
Yeah, those middle-of-the-field routes are going to be open a lot, especially against this cover two defense that Lovie Smith likes to run from his NFL days. And that was a post route, and Kamara Jarrett just found that open space and Spate threw a perfect dime to hit his receiver.
Two tight end set, Jake Butt and Asiasi, both to the right, out wide to the left is Kikoa Crawford. The give is to Smith running right up the middle, and he was met immediately. Trey Watson on the stop. Yeah. Tampa, Florida native delivering the boot.
Great individual play by Trey Watson, the outside linebacker. Read the play, smart play, and just met Davion Smith and his man against man, and Watson won that battle.
Second down and 10. The Michigan running game struggling thus far in the second half. Out wide to the left will be Darbo. Out wide to the right is McDoom. He comes in motion from right to left. And he'll be in the slot now on the left side as this one snapped. Play action. Spate dropping back. All sorts of time. Fires it out for Jake Butt. Catches it at the 30. And wrapped up at the 27-yard line. It is a 22-yard connection from Spate to Butt. Julian Jones finally brought down America's tight end, but not before he moves the chains for the Mesa Blue.
Yeah, Jake Butt is just a mismatch nightmare. Last time he had a big catch, he was matched up against a corner. This time he was matched up against Julian Jones, a linebacker, and Jones was just too slow to keep up with Butt, and he had a few steps ahead of him, and Butt was wide open to make the play near the sideline.
3 minutes to go here in the third quarter, Michigan leading 31-0. Offset eye with Ty Isaac out wide to the left. Spate drops back looking to throw. He fires it out to Kikoa Crawford, who cannot hang on. Freshman jitters perhaps playing a factor in that as he was poorly covered by Darius Mosley.
Yeah, Crawford, true freshman, has a big body and actually did use his body to get leverage, and he had a chance to make that play, but it was just the hands that failed him. You got to step up and make that play. Spate hit him right where it needed to be.
Spate's impressive performance, arguably the best game we've seen him play this year, continues, though, with another nicely thrown pass. Kikoa Crawford just can't help him out. Karan Higdon receives the pitch on second and 10, running out to the right side, gets across the 25, has blockers in front of him, spins off a would-be tackler, and picks up 9 yards on the second down carry. Third and very short, upcoming, well within Illinois territory and within the Illinois red zone.
Finally, a good positive run play for the Michigan run game. The linemen did a great job of getting to the second level. Illinois' linebackers have struggled getting off blocks, and Higdon did a good job of waiting behind that line. Now it's third and short, and let's see if Michigan can convert here.
Darbo out wide to the left. Khalid Hill, the fullback, dotting the eye is Higdon. The give is to Hill, running right up the middle. Fullback dive moves the chains with a 2-yard pickup.
I think that Khalid Hill dive is the most reliable play in all of college football. It's worked every time on the goal line for Harbaugh. In this case, it wasn't on the goal line, but it was third and short and an easy first down conversion for the Wolverines.
40th play on the ground in this game for Michigan, and that's a total of 182 yards now via the running attack. Spate with 249 yards through the air thus far on 15 completions, 21 attempts. Fresh set of downs for Michigan.
Yeah, Jawan Bushel-Beatty comes in as the sixth lineman.
Spade in the shotgun. Looking to throw. Fires it out to Darbo, and it's well behind him. He tried that back shoulder fade. Harbaugh wants a flag for pass interference. He won't get one.
Intended for Amara Darbo.
Yeah, it looked like Spate was trying that back shoulder fade, but he threw it a little bit too far to the sideline. Darbo did not have enough time to react to it, and it was interesting to see Bushel-Beatty out on that play, the sixth lineman. He has started the last few games after Grant Newsom went out with injury, but he was benched for the start of this game, and now he's come off the field, and Michigan will come out in regular set here.
1:38 to play in this third quarter, Michigan leading 31-0. Offset eye with Smith, the tailback. It's a fake give to Chesson on a wide receiver sweep. The give to Smith, and he picks up 2 yards and no further.
Gideon Smith moves the ball, Darren.
Yeah, the halfback dive right up the middle hasn't really been working for Michigan all game. Jimmy, and that's sort of the bread and butter for Jim Harbaugh's offense, so that's not a good sign. Got to give credit to Illinois' defensive line, though. They have a lot of guys they like to rotate out there. We mentioned Dewan Smoot as their best defensive lineman, but they have a lot of guys out there that can rotate in and play well, similar to Michigan's defensive line. So got to give them credit for bottling up that inside run.
And perhaps the impact of Chris Evans' injury being felt as well. He went out with an apparent concussion in the first half. Spate, third down and 8, fires it on a slant route.
Yeah, it looks like there's going to be offensive pass interference. It looked like there's a pick play there. That's why the receiver was so open.
And a name we haven't called often this season, Nate Johnson on the reception, but there is a flag down.
Offense, five players in the backfield, 5-yard penalty. Repeat third down.
And Harbaugh.
Penalty is declined. Fourth down.
And Harbaugh's livid. He's yelling at his quarterback, Wilton Spate. Michigan's offense likes to throw a lot of different formations out, and it looks like they had a miscommunication there. It's going to Illinois declined the penalty, so it's going to bring up a fourth down, and it looks like Michigan's bringing out the field goal unit out to get 3 points here.
And on that reception, we see Nate Johnson's red shirt burned as well, one of three players listed as number 25, one of two receivers on this Michigan roster. It'll be a field goal attempt for Kenny Allen. He's 1-for-1 on the day. He makes it 2-for-2, so at least for the moment, the kicking competition appears to be over. Kenny Allen, 2-for-2 on the day. That field goal from right down the middle finishes right down the middle. And Michigan has a 34-0 lead with 43 seconds still to play, coming off the 27-yard field goal for Kenny Allen. 10th place, going 60 yards in 4 minutes and 19 seconds, and Michigan continues to add to their lead.
Yeah, that's a really good sign for all Michigan fans out there. Kenny Allen's 2-for-2 on the day. He had an atrocious kicking day against Wisconsin three weeks ago at home in the Big House. He missed all of his field goals. He was 0-for-3. So it's a really good sign for all Michigan fans out there to see Kenny Allen hit two, albeit easy field goals. They weren't too far, but still he's gaining his confidence. Hopefully he can build his momentum going later in the season when the games mean more, and hopefully he can be a more reliable asset for Michigan special teams unit.
43 seconds left to go in this third quarter. Michigan getting ready to kick this one back off to the Illini, leading it 34-0. Kenny Allen 2-for-2 now on the day. Improves to 6 out of 10 on the season on field goal tries. Quinn Nordine, once again, not out there warming up this game, so the injury continues to linger for the true freshman who came in as the number one ranked kicker in the nation.
Let's see if Lovie Smith's going to come out with an answer. I think he did a great job of making halftime adjustments to make Michigan's offense better a few times in the third quarter. See if he can answer offensively. The defense has shown up. Illinois will receive this kickoff at the very end of the third quarter.
Allen boots this one away from the right hash marks. Kendrick Foster fields it 6 yards deep with his momentum trailing away from the field of play. He'll take a knee. Just wanted to update you. Colorado comes out on top at Stanford, a final score of 10-5. An ugly one, and Colorado, looking at the schedule ahead, an opportunity to really improve their status. They'll go back to Boulder to face UCLA before traveling in a very winnable game in Tucson against the University of Arizona, Washington State, and Utah to end the year. So two tough games for the Buffalo, but their path to a Pac-12 South Division title improved with their big victory at the farm today as Stanford struggles continue this season. 1st and 10 for Illinois. Jeff George in the shotgun on the left hash mark. He will give it to Reggie Corbin, who makes a cutback, but to no avail. Wrapped up by Rashawn Gary for no gain.
Yeah, this is Corbin's first carry of the second half. Kendrick Foster has been carrying most of the load, but then Lovie Smith likes to use different running backs to help him stay fresh for the 60 minutes of the game. And it looks like there's 18 seconds left. I think Illinois might just let the clock run out there.
They appear in no hurry to get this play off. I believe, Will Yang, you are correct. That will do it. This is the end of the third quarter. Michigan leads it after three quarters of play, adding a field goal to their lead in this third quarter. Michigan 34, Illinois nothing on the Michigan Football Student Radio Network, WCBN FM, Ann Arbor. Will, your thoughts on that third quarter of play?
Third quarter was a lot different than the first half, but if you're counting just the third quarter, Michigan won that 3-0, and that's not really what you want to see for your third best team in the country. I think Lovie Smith made a lot of great adjustments on the defensive end. They were able to stop the running game, and Leo mentioned this earlier, but Michigan's passing game has been more of a threat, which is something we are not used to seeing for Michigan offenses. Chris Evans' injury could play a significant role in affecting Michigan's depth at running back. Michigan still has a lot of guys that can throw out there, but Chris Evans is unique in his quickness and slipperiness in open space that the running backs, the other running backs on the roster don't have. So We'll try to keep you updated on the concussion. He probably won't come back. Won't come back today against Illinois, but we'll keep you updated on how he continues throughout the season with that concussion. That could be a big factor in Michigan going forward, but I think Michigan has to find a way. I know it's 34-0 still. I think this game is pretty much in Michigan's hand, but they have to find a way to open this game up more, because like I said, I think they have this one in wraps, but it looks like Illinois has been stymied them for the third quarter. And out of town, we just talked about the Colorado game, but Alabama has retaken the lead against Texas A&M. It's 6:33 left in the third quarter. Alabama leads 20-14. Alabama, the first ranked team in the country. Texas A&M is 6. And 4 years ago, Texas A&M and Alabama, Texas A&M pulled a shocking upset in Tuscaloosa. The quarterback by the name of Johnny Manziel, Johnny Football, who later went on to win the Heisman. And Trevor Knight, the transfer from Oklahoma, leading Texas A&M right now. We'll see if he has some magic, just like Johnny Football did. And starting the fourth quarter, Illinois will open the fourth quarter on their own 25-yard line. It's going to be 2nd and 10. The receivers are talking to some coach on the sideline. Refs are still not letting them play. Refs are still not begun the clock yet. And some other out-of-town scores. Western Michigan has opened up the lead against their rival Eastern Michigan. Big game for both directional Michigan schools. Both of them have had great starts to the season. Western Michigan is undefeated, ranked 20th. And Eastern Michigan trying to stay alive, fight for bowl eligibility. They are 5-2 right now. North Carolina continuing to beat up on Virginia. North Carolina, a really surprising team in the ACC. We talked a lot about Louisville, Clemson, Florida State, but North Carolina is a team that can maybe turn some heads over there in the Atlantic Athletic Conference. And looks like the play's about to get started here in the Bakehouse. Again, I'm Will Yang alongside Leo Blavin. Jeff George Jr., the quarterback, lined up in the pistol. Got Reggie Corbin, the running back, behind him. Three receivers to his left. And they check the sideline to pick up a play. George addressing his linemen, telling the play. They switch to a different formation. Lines up in the shotgun, drops back to pass. And hits his receiver. That's Zach Grant on a quick out route for
George's
a gain of two.
Pass complete to Zach Grant, covered by Delano Gill.
They're giving scoreline no reason for Illinois to slow things down anymore.
It's going to be 3rd down 7. Jeff George again checks the sideline for the play. Three receivers to the right this time. Turner in the slot, closest to quarterback on the right. Takes a snap, drops back to pass, looks downfield, has plenty of time. And throws it behind Turner. Turner had a lot of space there. It's incomplete.
Yeah, Turner had Delano Hill beat well downfield. The poor throw, the only reason for that incompletion. Nice run route by Turner, Illinois' leading receiver, who's found separation at times throughout this game, but Georgia's struggles continue now. Just 3 of 13. And Jabril Pepper is another opportunity to add to his Heisman campaign here.
Yeah, the incompletion leads to a 4th and 6 Illinois punt. And it's a low line drive kick. Peppers calls for a fair catch. Even though he had plenty of room, the crowd not happy about his decision. And
Peppers,
I think Jabril's regretting it too.
Yeah, that's one he really is going to wish he had back, because there was a good 15 yards of open space in front of him. Perhaps that was just the call from the sideline, though. At this point in the game, no reason to risk injury on a punt return for arguably Michigan's most important and certainly best punt.
14 minutes left to go in the fourth quarter. Michigan will start out this drive following the Jabril Peppers fair catch on their 25-yard line. Michigan comes out in the I formation. Looks like John O'Korn, the second-string quarterback, is leading the team out. Poggi, the fullback, and Ty Isaac, the running back, behind him. Hand off to Isaac. Isaac has some room, takes it to the sideline, and he's brought down by Trey Walker, but there is a flag on the play.
Yeah, they're going to get, I think it's the freshman Tyrone Wheatley Jr. for the hold.
Holding, offense, number 19, 10-yard penalty, repeat first down.
And the hold was on Henry Pogge, so that will be a 10-yard penalty. Remains first down, coming up first and 20 for the Wolverines.
And not the cleanest game penalty-wise for Michigan. That's the fourth penalty against the Wolverines. Illinois, on the other hand, pretty clean game for them with only four penalties. Illinois came into this one as one of the most penalized teams in the country, second most, in fact, in the country, averaging nearly nine a game.
McCorn hands it off to Ty Isaac again, and he's smothered in the backfield. Looks like it's about going to be a gain of zero on that.
Yeah, Michigan at this point in the game with McCorn in. Really no need for them to increase their lead except for the folks in the desert. This game certainly well in hand.
Yeah, it looks like all the second stringers are out for the Wolverines. McCorn lined up in the shotgun with Caron Hignan as the back in the backfield. Two receivers to the left, one at the right. McCorn takes a snap, fakes the handoff, gives it to Mo Ways on a wide receiver screen, and he's met immediately by Hardy Nickerson, the middle linebacker for the Fighting Illini.
Yeah, Nickerson leads the Big Ten in tackles, and he really has had to cover a lot of ground this game from that Mike linebacker position. Another poor blocking effort, though, by Juwan Bushelbeating on that design bubble screen. He didn't start this game. In fact, he was replaced by former left guard Ben Braid, now starting at the left tackle spot, but another missed block there for Bushelbeating. Forces third and an obvious passing down.
Third and long here. One running back in the backfield. That's Higdon. And he gets the draw play. And he has lots of room to go. Makes a move at the 30. And he's pushed out of bounds eventually by Trey Watson. But looks like he had enough to pick up the first down. What a play by Caron Higdon.
And that's just poor coaching. On third and long with this score, you almost have to expect a delayed draw. So much green grass in front of him. There were only two white shirts on that half of the field. And all Higdon had to do was use his speed, get to the edge, and it was all over. Poor blocking downfield by Mo Ways, and it still didn't matter with just two Illinois players anywhere in that same zip code.
So Higdon's drive keeps, his run keeps the drive going. McCorn fakes the handoff to Ty Isaac, rolls right, has plenty of room in front of him. He's going to tuck the ball and run, and he'll pick up a gain of about 3 yards. He was brought down by Hardy Nickerson again.
Brought down by Hardy Nickerson.
And Michigan, I'd like to see John O'Corn get more opportunities to run. He was praised for his athleticism coming into the University of Michigan, getting to see some of his speed there. Certainly not a play you'll see run often with Wilton Spade under center, but O'Corn certainly a more athletic option as the signal caller for Michigan.
O'Corn lines up again, two receivers to the left, none to the right. Sends McDoom in motion and gives it to him for the reverse. He has some room on the edge, breaks a tackle, and he's eventually wrestled down by Jalen Dunlap, the quarterback.
Yeah, Dunlap did a really good job because there were great blocks upfield by Asiasi and Tyrone Wheatley Jr. Two guys normally playing tight end lined up out wide to the right, and they had good upfield blocking. McDoom, all he had between him and potentially the end zone was Jalen Dunlap, but give the cornerback from Chicago a lot of credit for busting up that play before it got very big.
Yeah, James Crawford, also the linebacker from Florida, was in on that play. Two receivers to the left, third down and two for the Wolverines. Asiasi in motion, Caron Hignan, the single tailback. Corn, quick drop back, QB draw, runs in himself, and he's going to be tackled right near the marker. It's probably going to be fourth and short for the Wolverine, and some decisions for Jim Harbaugh here.
Unclear if that was the play design there, as Corn seemed to tuck that very quickly. Harbaugh looking at the spot and deciding whether or not Michigan goes for it. They certainly have the capability of picking up fourth and one rather easily, as we've seen all year, but I think just given this scoreline, no reason for Kenny Allen not to go out there and the rest of the punting team join him.
And it looks like Jamal Milan, one of the Illinois defensive tackles, is shaken up on the plays, lying on the ground near midfield, attended by the training staff. One of Illinois' most trusted defensive linemen. Mentioned that Levy Smith likes to rotate a lot of guys in, and it's a shame to see a player like that go down right here. Some big some big other scores that have from games that have finished already. Louisville, number 7 in the country, blew out NC State, who a lot of people thought was a pretty strong team in the ACC. 54-13, Lamar Jackson continues his high school campaign. As looks like Milan is up now, being helped off the field. Looks like a left leg injury. He's sort of favoring his other leg. Let's hope that he's okay as players from both sides return to the field.
Fourth down and one upcoming. The punting unit out there, which will draw some boos from the fans, but given the score and the field position, it would be somewhat surprising to see Michigan go for it.
Here's the final score. Slippery Rock, 35. Edinburgh University, 37.
Another out-of-town score. Slippery Rock loses a nail biter to Edinburgh University, 35-37. Nebraska continues its top 10 season with a win over Purdue, 24-14. They're still in the fourth quarter, but Nebraska's up 10 with 10 minutes left to go. UCLA nodded down 21-17 to the 19th ranked Utah Utes at halftime. And a big SEC matchup, Arkansas, 17th ranked team in the country versus number 21 Auburn, down 0-7 early in the first quarter. And another Big Ten score, Wisconsin beats the Iowa Hawkeyes 17-9. Both of those teams could make a play to win their half of the division in the Big Ten. Looks like the players are finally taking their positions. Fourth and short here for the Wolverines. Kenny Allen sent back to punt it deep to Illinois return man Darius Mosley. Oh, it's a fake snap. The long snapper snapped it to the up man, but he dropped it, and Illinois right there to make the play.
Yeah, and it appeared Sibniewski direct snapped it to Ben Gedeon. Gedeon, either that was a bad snap or he just wasn't ready for it. No, it was a designed play. Gedeon just a bit over anxious, and Illinois had that one pretty well read anyway. So I think even with the clean snap exchange from Sibniewski to Gedeon, it probably wouldn't have mattered. Illinois very alert there. And one special teams blunder finally for Michigan in this game.
Yeah, gotta love the savagery for Jim Harbaugh, but Illinois sniffed it out. And now Illinois is driving on their Michigan 45-yard line, lined up in the power eye. George under center, hands it off, takes the handoff to Foster, rolls right, looks downfield, throws it deep to Turner. Turner goes up and makes a play. Touchdown, Illinois. He made the catch right over Delano Hill.
And that's a way to respond after a bad fake punt. Go for the home run play. And poor coverage there, taken advantage of by Malik Turner, his fourth touchdown of the year. And the shutout streak ends for the Wolverine defense. As Delano Hill just tried to high point the football, Malik Turner did a much better job of that. Hill seemed lost in coverage. Turner wide open as he elevated. No one coming close to his vertical ability in Michigan secondary, and Illinois with the touchdown.
So Illinois finally able to end the shutout.
Substitution, 12 men on defense. Half the distance to the goal.
Looks like a substitution infraction on Michigan, but the refs are still confused. It looks like they had 12 men on the field as Devin Bush Jr. comes off. Refs are still discussing and explaining things to the Illinois sideline. A lot of confusion going on.
Penalty will be enforced half the distance on the PAT.
Yeah, I think the Illinois coaching staff, in particular their special teams coach Bob Ligasecki, I think he was hoping that they could tack on that penalty yardage to the kickoff. That's not the case, with the penalty coming before the point after try. And I guess when you gain the yard and a half for the PAT, you might as well go for two, trailing 34-6.
Fighting Illini are lining up. Looks like they have their offense out, so they will be going for two. Move the ball to the left hash, which is an option. I guess they feel more comfortable going there. And the offense does, in fact, come back out onto the field. Jeff George in the shotgun. Foster, the running back, by his side. Kerner goes in motion. Three receivers now to the right. Takes the shotgun snap, looks to throw, and that's cut for the two-point conversion. That's Zach Grant.
Yeah, nice little slant route and a yard and a half with 8 yards of separation
for the two-point conversion. Score is Michigan 34, Illinois 8.
Dribbling was in decent position, but just a well-thrown ball, and the shutout streak ends, much to the dismay of the Michigan fans who elected to stay through the remainder of this game.
Yeah, the crowd has died out significantly, but some news raining down after the two-point conversion.
For home crowd attendance, today marks the 271st game of more than 100,000 at Michigan Stadium.
And that will end the streak at
Thank
seven
you.
Quarters
for being part
as Michigan
of the largest crowd
shut out
watching a football
Rutgers
game
the
anywhere
game.
In America today. Our attendance for today's game,
the attendance being announced, 111,103. Fans were in attendance at today's game.
And go Blue.
The big house, the biggest stadium in America. Going back to some other out-of-town scores, number 14, Boise State won a very close game against BYU on Thursday, 28-17. And the Boise State Broncos stay 7-0, and maybe make a case for themselves in the college football hunt. Some big games later tonight that haven't started, Washington versus Oregon State. Washington, number 5, undefeated in the Pac-12. A lot of people have them as favorites to get in to the college football playoffs from the Pac-12. We'll see if they can keep it going against Oregon State again. That game is at 6:30. Michigan's rival, Ohio State, number 2, also undefeated, will go into Happy Valley and face James Franklin's Penn State squad, 4-2. That game kicks off at 8 p.m. Another big SEC matchup, Ole Miss, 3-3, somehow still ranked number 23 in the nation, will travel to Louisiana to play the Louisiana State Tigers, 4-2 in the SEC. They are ranked 25th. That game kicks off at 9 p.m. Illinois set to kick it off. First time they've kicked it off since the opening kickoff, as they've only scored one touchdown on the game. Michigan lined up close to the ball just in case for an inside onside kick, but then they drop back. Jabril Peppers, the lone man, set to receive the kickoff. Chase McLaughlin, the kicker for Illinois, and he kicks it deep. Jabril Peppers returns it at the 1 yard line. He has time to return it. Runs toward the middle of the field, cutting towards the right sideline. He has room, and he's brought down by the 40-yard line.
Jabril Peppers
he's brought down by Chase McLaughlin,
to the
kicker.
38-yard line. Tackled by Nathan Ecker.
Tackled by Nathan Ecker, the fullback. Michigan second string players coming out on the field. O'Korn going to be under center again for his second drive of the day.
First and 10, Michigan.
Michigan fullback Bobby Henderson comes into the game to see his first action of the day. Lines up in the offset eye with Henderson at the fullback and Isaac as the running back. Asiasi in motion. O'Korn bobbles the handoff, gets it to Isaac, but he is smothered behind the line of scrimmage. It's going to be a loss of one to bring up second and 11.
Yeah, this game is going to go especially slow as we wind down to the conclusion. Michigan not really going to open up much of the playbook and no real reason to at this point in the game. But expect to see more just handoffs right up the middle.
Yeah, especially after that failed fake punt, I think Harbaugh is going to take a little bit. He's going to try to chill a little bit on the creativity front. Two fullbacks now in the game. Asiasi was lined up at the fullback, but now goes to his regular tight end position. Toss to Isaac, running left, has some blocks, makes a move, and he's eventually pushed out of bounds by Nickerson.
Isaac, the ball carrier. Harvey Nickerson forced him out of bounds.
Looked like it would be a gain of about 5 yards. He was forced out of bounds, so that stops the clock and brings up a 3rd and 9.
Third down and 9.
Michigan lined up with a single running back, and now Henderson moves in motion to make it an offset eye. O'Korn fakes the handoff, play action, looks downfield, throws to well-covered.
Yeah, and there was a very late hit there, so O'Korn's Michigan's going to pick up the first down. Silly play for Illinois there. O'Korn got hit low and late.
He tried to hit Drake Harris, but he was covered by Jalen Dunlap. Let's hear what the refs have to say.
Personal foul, roughing the passer with targeting. Defense, number 33. The play is under further review.
So one of the new rules, and a good rule, quite frankly, every targeting call is automatically reviewed. They will not be reviewing the roughing the passer. That cannot be overturned. A roughing penalty, though, can. And they'll also be looking to determine if Trey Watson's night is over, which would have a bigger impact on the Illinois matchup next week against Minnesota, as Watson would be suspended for the first half of that game as well if he's in fact called for the targeting penalty.
Yeah, Minnesota is a very winnable game for Illinois. They were able to beat Rutgers by a slim margin of 2 points.
Yeah, they needed that field goal at the end of regulation. So this is a big decision, not necessarily for this game, but for Illinois' next matchup. Is Watson an impact outside linebacker for this Fighting Illini defense?
Watching the replay, it did look like after O'Korn had released the ball, Watson took a few extra steps and hit him in the helmet. I think that's what the refs will probably be looking for, is the helmet hit, whether that was enough to merit a targeting penalty.
The ruling of targeting is confirmed. Number 33 is disqualified for the remainder of the contest.
And again, not really a big impact with this game already well out of hand, but Trey Watson will be suspended for the first half of their weekend game, next weekend, I should say, against Minnesota.
Yeah, and that was just a dumb play by Watson. He just took a few extra steps, didn't need to. O'Korn had clearly released the ball, and he takes an early exit. He walks through the tunnel of the Michigan Big House locker room.
And thankfully for Michigan, O'Korn not shaken up on that play.
Yeah, O'Korn's back under center, eye formation, hands it off to Karan Higdon, the tailback. Higdon has some room, burst to the outside. He's at the 30, the 20, the 10. Will he make it? He breaks the tackle, and he's brought down right at the goal line, but that's going to be a Michigan touchdown.
What a run. Karan Higdon, so much speed on the edge. I do think they may have missed a hold just on that right side of the line, but it won't matter. The Michigan fans certainly won't care. An electrifying run by the sophomore. Higdon has shown throughout the season when he's gotten touches in open space, he probably has the best speed of anyone in the open field in terms of Michigan running backs. He showed it there. What a run. 45 yards for Karan Higdon.
And Ryan Tice will be on to make the extra point. His first appearance in the game, he was the other kicker in the competition with Kenny Allen that we mentioned at the beginning of the show. Kicks it, and it's right through the middle. The extra point is good. Michigan extends the lead. The score is now 41-8. And with 8 minutes and 48 minutes left to go in the fourth quarter, again, Michigan leads 41-8.
Higdon, have yourself a day. That run puts him over the century mark. 100 yards even on the ground through 6 carries. Another impressive performance. And you do wonder at what point he's going to start being in that more regular rotation, as he's really received the bulk of the garbage time carries, but we haven't seen him much early. Saw more this game given the Chris Evans concussion injury. And obviously you don't want to see Chris Evans unable to play next weekend against Michigan State. But if that's the case, Karan Higdon certainly fits the mold as the shifty, elusive back to complement Ty Isaac and Davion Smith, who are more bruising tailbacks.
Yeah, and this was Michigan's second string in against Illinois starters, and Higdon made them look silly on that play. Breaking a few tackles near the goal line, Higdon was able to score. Quick drive, 1 minute 34 second drive, just 3 plays and 61 yards, ending on Ron Higdon's big play. Higdon leads all running backs in this game with 100 yards. That touchdown brought him just to exactly 100 yards on only six attempts. Davion Smith has taken the bulk of a load of 18 carries. He has 76 yards to show for and also a touchdown. Ty Isaac with 9 carries and 32 yards. And that's about it for the running backs. Eddie McDew, more of a slot receiver type player, has 2 carries for 23 yards. Bill Spade is done for the day, but he went 16 for 23 yards, 253. Sorry, 16 for 23 completions, 253 yards, and 2 touchdowns. John O'Horn only in on 2 drives so far, but he's 1 for 1, perfect 100% completion rate, and just for 2 yards. Jeff George on the opposing side has gone 4 for 14 with 95 yards and 1 touchdown, 1 interception. The passer rating of 94.9. So the players take the field for the kickoff. Looks like it won't be Kenny Allen out there. It will be James Fogg, the transfer walk-on from Cal Poly, from Palo Alto, California.
Kicking off for Michigan is James Fogg,
the left-footed kicker.
Illinois, Kendrick Foster.
Played both football and baseball at Palo Alto High School.
Did you know him?
I did not know him, but I did meet him at Michigan. He was a year above me in high school. And Foster has room to run, and he's eventually chased down by Keith Washington.
Scribbling, really pressing hard, trying to strip that football fraction that was.
Brought down by
Keith Washington, chasing down, trying to strip that football. We've seen a few good returns in this game, and I think that's just a poor kick there. You want to clear it out of the end zone, your former Viking teammate and classmate.
Yeah, and also just very poor coverage. Foster had plenty of room to go.
First and 10, Illinois
is going to line up in the I formation again. Nathan Eckert as the fullback. And looks like Reggie Corbin, the running back, to dot the I. Two receivers to the right. Malik Turner in the slot. George scanning the Michigan defense. Tells his line and running backs an audible. Play clock at 5. Does he have time to get it off? He does get it off. Hands it off to Corbin, who's met by Chase Winovich in the backfield.
What a great play, great penetration. Winovich lined up on the opposite side that run was intended for. Closed with great speed, wrapped up Foster and threw him to the turf. And he was getting held on that play, too.
The loss of about 3 yards is going to bring up 2nd and 13 for the Fighting Illini. Illini looking to the sideline to receive a call. The coaches on the sideline are holding up giant signs. Illinois in the I formation with Foster now in at running back. Malik Turner, receiver to the left, comes in motion. Play action. George looks downfield, throws it deep to Turner again. Turner jumps and is not able to make a play there. Good coverage by Delano Hill.
Credit Winovich once again getting in there, providing the pressure. George couldn't step into that throw, but once again, we're seeing Malik Turner finding holes in this backup secondary.
Yeah, LeVert Hill, the true freshman from Detroit, was also in on that play. Now, 3rd and long for the Illini. 3 receivers spread out to the left as Jeff George again checks the sideline to see the giant signs being held up by the coaches. Foster in at running back. Again, 3 receivers to the left. Turner in the slot. George looks downfield, and he's brought down by Maurice Hurst on the blitz. Had nowhere to go on that.
At any other team in the country, Mo Hurst would be a starter and probably the best defensive lineman. Just with Michigan's depth, he usually is playing not only starting roles, but garbage time as well, and it's just an unfair matchup. Regardless of the offensive lineman, he was running like a defensive end. The problem is he plays inside and just no one able to stop him for Illinois. And if it wasn't him, it would have been Chase Winovich. Pick your poison if you're Illinois. It doesn't matter. Michigan loves spreading the wealth.
Ryan Frain to punt it deep to Peppers. Peppers has some room, but he's going to let it go over his head, and it's going to bounce harmlessly into the end zone for a touchback.
A booming punt there. I guess if you're not going to kick it out of bounds or away from Peppers, kick it in the end zone is another way to prevent a return. Michigan will take it with 7:05 left. The only people I think still listening or watching are people with a little extra incentive, and they need another Michigan score to finish this one satisfied.
Yeah, fans are slowly trickling out of the Big House. The student section is about one quarter of its full capacity right now. The second string unit is still out there for Michigan. Against Rutgers, we saw some third stringers even, but it's going to be John O'Korn under center again. Offset eye, two receivers, one each to the left and right. O'Korn drops back, throws a deep shot downfield, and that's well covered by Dunlap. He was looking for Eddie McDoom on that, but
O'Korn's
nothing going there for O'Korn.
Yeah, the throw in another situation I would say is ill-advised, but why not take your shots at this point? Great coverage, though, on that play for Illinois. I believe getting out there in coverage was... Just trying to get another look at that, and I think it was Darius Mosley. Correction, Jalen Dunlap on the cover.
Michigan lines up in the offset eye. One receiver to the left is Crawford. Pitch to Karan Higdon. Higdon has some room. Good blocking, but he's eventually wrestled down by host of Fighting Illini.
Yeah, good contain by the edge there for Illinois. Not giving him that sideline, forcing him to cut back. And there was good blocking, but there were just too many white shirts in the area. Higdon, always looking for the explosive play. Takes what the defense gives him there. Smart run.
It's going to be third and six.
Gain of seven.
Gain of four on that play. Michigan lines up. Single tailback again. Higdon, two receivers to the top. Tight end is Tyrone Wheatley Jr., who goes in motion, drops back, quick drop back, tries to hit Eddie McDoom on a slant, but it's bobbled and it looks like it was caught by Wheatley.
Yeah, Tyrone Wheatley caught that bobbled pass.
Caught by Tyrone Wheatley.
A different way of going about things, but it worked nonetheless.
And what looked like to be a blown up play turns out to be a first down conversion, and Michigan moves the chains again.
You know, when you're right, you're right. That's just a good play being made. Give McDoom credit as well, tipping that one up. Wheatley dove on it and made the reception. You just hope at this point, no need to review it given the scoreline. Let's keep going.
Hand off to Higdon on first down. He's met right at the line of scrimmage by the Illinois defensive lineman.
Looks
like Chunky Clements was one of the main culprits on that play. It's going to be second and 10 as he was met right at the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, James Crawford, the backup linebacker, in there for the ejected Trey Watson in on the play as well. The running game continues to be a struggle for Michigan. I say that with them averaging 5.1 yards per carry, but you take away a few of the longer runs, and there have been quite a few, just the 4 or 5 yard runs we're accustomed to have not been easy to come by for Michigan.
Back to the offset eye now. O'Korn hands it off to Ty Isaac. Isaac has some room. He's met by Nickerson right in the second level, and he's eventually wrestled down right at the 45-yard line.
And with 5 minutes to go, no reason for Michigan to start throwing it, except on third downs. But it's tough for the running game to really thrive at the end of the game when both sides know it's coming. And I think that's more an explanation for the struggles so far in the second half running the football, as Michigan doesn't want to run up the score by continuing to throw it, and Illinois' defense simply much better than Rutgers was 2 weeks ago at stopping the run.
Third and five, Michigan lines up once again in the offset. Two receivers at the top to O'Korn's right. O'Korn play action, drops back, rolls to his right, finds an open Henderson. Henderson catches it, and he's going downfield into Illinois' territory, brought down at the 42-yard line.
Savvy play for the New York native as well, staying in bounds, keeps the clock running. Not that it really matters at this point.
First down, Michigan.
It looks like the true freshman,
ball is now at the 42-yard line,
Joe Hewlett, out there as well. We're actually the junior Joe Hewlett, but the number 27 stuck out to me immediately. He's not a guy who sees much of the field at all. He's going to be the tailback on this one. Michigan will have to use a timeout, though.
Timeout, Michigan. They're first. This will be a 30-second timeout.
Looks like Michigan trying to get a little too cute with their substitutions, and has to call a very unnecessary timeout late in the game. There's 4 minutes left to go in the fourth quarter. Michigan up 41-8 against the Illini. Looking at some out-of-town scores again, Alabama has extended its lead 32-14. Not sure if Trevor Knight has the same magic that Johnny Football has over there.
Doesn't look quite like it.
Ohio State, Alabama, the number one team, looks like we'll come out with the win here. Ohio State and Washington, number 2 and 5 teams, play later tonight. Clemson, the number 3 team in the country, has a bye this week. And Michigan, number 3 right now against Illinois. Back on the field, offset eye again, one receiver to the left. Hands it off to Ty Isaac. Excuse me, that's Joe Hewlett, who has seen his first action in the game. And he's able to get past the line of scrimmage for a gain of 1 yard.
Brought down by Jalen Novi. The Novi Michigan native, right of Northville High School. I expect that, and I can't say for certain, but I expect that to have been the first time he's ever touched a ball in a game for the Bays and the Blue.
Hewlett remains in the game. Two fullbacks this time. Two receivers to the right and the left of Okorn. Corn hands it right back to Hewlett. Hewlett makes a few cuts, and he's able to get another gain of 1 yard to bring up a 3rd and 8.
Just good penetration. Henry McGrew in there. And Illinois is going to continue to load the box. Joe Beneducci out there as a running back on this one. So keep the roster up, Will, this Wolverine offense, no shortage of running backs, it appears.
Yeah, Beneducci, the quick throw to,
we've got Drake Harris.
Quick throw to Drake Harris, who records his first reception of the day.
Fourth and short. I wouldn't have hated to see Michigan attempt the long field goal just to see what they have going forward.
But it looks like the offense stays on the field, and 12 different Michigan players have run the ball today. So Jim Harbaugh continuing to spread that well. Looks like Hewlett will be the player here on 4th and 2, and another called timeout by Jim Harbaugh.
Timeout, Michigan, their second. This will be a 30-second timeout.
And it, Kenny Allen entering the field as well. I'd like to see him attempt the field goal, to be honest with you, at this point. Just find out what you have in your kicking game going forward. A no-pressure situation, but still a game situation.
And I think that's what Harbaugh is doing as Kenny Allen is on the field to warm up. It looks like he might actually be warming up his punting, so maybe Harbaugh called a timeout to set up a punt, but we will see soon enough what the call will be.
Michigan has chosen to challenge the spot of the forward progress in relation to the line to gain. We'll review the play.
How about that, Will? And with 2:04 left to go in a 33-point game. And I will say, I don't disagree with the challenge because I thought immediately it looked like they didn't give up forward progress.
Well, I guess that's...
It looks like he's still going to be a half yard short, but maybe they give Michigan a yard. I just don't know what you gain with the score line the way it is.
Yeah, I think a lot of the fans here are kind of not happy with Harbaugh's decision. It's pretty cold out. I think a lot of these fans want to go home, but it looks like a lot of people in the front, at least of the student section, are still enjoying their time at the big house.
Yeah, but there's a lot of people, maybe not in the stadium, who need Michigan to score another touchdown.
And I guess that just shows the competitiveness of Jim Harbaugh, up by more than 30 points with only 2 minutes left to go in the game. He still wants to win. He still wants every little advantage. And sure, it might be annoying to some of these fans here struggling in the cold, but I think it's what you want in your head coach if you want to win the national championship. And I think, Leo, you're right. He was tackled right at the marker. He was marked 2 yards short, which I think.
Yeah, I just don't know. Do you overturn it when they does? He didn't pick up the first down. I don't think they're going to have an angle. But yeah, I think we both agree he earned another yard that he was given. The problem is they marked him 2 yards short. Let's see what the official Ron Snodgrass has to say.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. The receiver was short of the line to gain. Fourth down.
Well, not wrong in his wording. Perhaps still wrong with the spot. Let's see if they move Michigan up a yard.
It's charged with timeout, and it may not challenge for the remainder of the contest.
And boos rain down from the Big House faithful, the fans that have stayed to the very bitter end of this game. Harbaugh not happy.
The spot's still wrong. I mean, they did mark him a yard shorter than he actually picked up, but he certainly didn't pick up the first down. Michigan's going to have to go for it.
And the offense is on the field, lined up in the power eye. Two tight ends set, one on either side. And he gives it to Henderson, the fullback, plows ahead, and I think he has just enough for the first down.
He needed 2 yards. He got 2.25.
Bobby Henderson was the ball carrier.
Now the kneel down likely upcoming.
First down, Michigan. Ball now at the 32-yard line.
Nick Volk in there now is another fullback. Michigan seemingly 15 fullbacks on this roster.
And it looks like Michigan will line up in victory formation. Drake Harris, the deep man. And O'Korn will take the snap and take a knee. Let the clock dribble out.
Good showing from O'Korn today in garbage time. 4-5 with 38 yards, timely passes. He showed his elusiveness running the ball as well. But just a really solid victory for Michigan this game. The defense continued to play great except for a blown coverage with the backup secondary in there. But certainly a lot for Michigan to build off of momentum-wise as they had to their biggest game to date this season, and one that has been circled on Michigan fans' calendars since the nightmare a season ago, as the Wolverines will travel to East Lansing. And I know you and I will be there in different capacities next weekend in East Lansing for one of the great rivalries in all of college football.
Yeah, Korn takes a knee again there, and Michigan State has dominated Michigan in the past few years, despite being dominated by much of the course of college football history. And now things are starting to change. The Spartans aren't the team that a lot of people thought they were at the beginning of the season. Michigan having one of the best seasons in a long time. And you never know what's going to happen in a game like that, though. 20 seconds left on the clock. O'Korn takes the last knee of the game. And the coaches go on the field.
Downs the ball.
And the ball game is over. Final score, Michigan 41, Illinois 8. I'm Will Yang, alongside Leo Blavin. Thank you for listening. This is WCBN Sports, FM Ann Arbor, 88.3. Again, I'm Will Yang, alongside Leo Blavin. Before, we were joined with by Jeremy Parks, Eli Sherman, and Morris Fabry. Just want to wish you all a good night and go Blue.